Abner, listen, the man is just about to say it.
Yeah, let's everybody listen.
The USA Radio Network presents the greatest radio programs of all time.
Henry! Henry Aldrich!
Coming, Mother.
The CBS Radio Workshop, dedicated to man's imagination, the theater of the mind.
This is classic radio theater.
Want to get away from it all?
The FBI in Peace and War.
Fibber, McGee, and Molly.
The unexpected.
The unexpected.
The unexpected.
Now here's your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends.
Lou Ayres and Lionel Barrymore in an episode of The Story of Dr. Kildare as it was broadcast 67 years ago today, March 30th, 1951, the story of Nurse Joan Quinn. And we thank you for joining us on this Saturday, the 30th day of March, the 89th day of the year, 276 days remaining till we get to 2020. The Florida Territory created in the U.S. in 1822, anesthesia used for the first time in an operation in 1842 by Dr. Crawford Long. Hyman Lippmann patented a pencil with an attached eraser on this date in 1858. And in 1867, Alaska purchased for $7.2 million, about 2 cents an acre, by Secretary of State William H. Seward. The news media called it Seward's folly. The Queensboro Bridge opened on this date in 1909, linking Manhattan and Queens. And the Mississippi Legislature founded the University of Southern Mississippi on this date in 1910. Premiering on Broadway on this date in 1951, The King and I.
Oh, good morning, Your Majesty.
You think you teach King lesson, but this is one lesson you do not be paid for teaching. In future, you will stop instructing wives and children in silly English song, Home Sweet House. In order to remind me of breaking promises I never make, etc., etc., etc.
Yul Brynner and Gertrude Lawrence starring in the opening on Broadway of The King and I on this date in 1951. Merv Griffin's game show Jeopardy made its debut on television on this date in 1964. Art Fleming hosting the original version on NBC. In 1981, President Reagan shot in the chest outside a Washington, D.C. hotel by John Hinckley Jr.
Shots rang out as President Reagan was leaving the hotel and about to enter his limousine. At least one person was hit and fell to the sidewalk with blood coming from his body. It was not the president. I don't know whether the president was hit. I do not believe he was. His car left rapidly under police escort. The shots were fired by someone in the crowd of people watching the president depart.
Now, as the events were breaking, Secretary of State Alexander Haig spoke to the media at the White House.
As of now, I am in control here in the White House, pending return of the vice president, and I'm in close touch with him. If something came up, I would check with him, of course.
Considering that Vice President Bush was not immediately available, Haig's statement represented a political reality, if not necessarily legal reality. It was on this date in 1982, the space shuttle mission STS-3 completed with the landing of the Columbia space shuttle at White Sands Missile Range, New Mexico. And in 2007, SpaceX conducted the world's first reflight of an orbital-class rocket. Passing away on this date in history, English celebrity and dandy Beau Brummel, radio commentator Gabriel Heater, Harold Perry, the great Gildersleeve, passing away on this date in 1985 of a heart attack, James Cagney in 1986, Gary Morton, the last husband of Lucille Ball, Alistair Cook, the journalist, singer Timmy Euro Hurt, and stand-up comedian Mitch Hedberg. Also the birth date today of Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh, British musician bandleader Ted Heath, singer Frankie Lane, and Randy Van Warmer, just when I needed you most. From the Hollywood Squares, the master of the squares, Peter Marshall, 93 today. Gomez in the Addams Family, the television show at least. John Astin is 89. Raul Paris, who got into little trouble for tying more than a kangaroo down. 89. Warren Beatty, 82. Eric Clapton, 74. Paul Reiser, 62. MC Hammer's time, because MC Hammer's 57. Tracy Chapman, driving a fast car at 55. From Beverly Hills 90210, Ian Zerling is 54. From Baywatch, the original Baywatch, Donna DeErico is 51. Celine Dion, also 51, as is Tim Hawkins.
So a while back, I put out a Facebook post asking people for ideas of Christian cuss words. I got over 10,000 responses from you freaks. Now, none of these is for me. You can't put it on me. Over 10,000 from you bozos. It took me 2 weeks to go through them, and I whittled it down to about 100 or so Christian alternative cuss words that you could use. I haven't memorized it yet, but I'd like to recite it for you right now. So Christians, just take these and cuss up a storm. Listen up. Here we go. Shucks, rats, gadzooks, shizzle, toot. Crapola. Which I guess is Spanish for crap. I don't know. Crapola. You almost stepped in crapola. Or it's the worst crayon color ever. Hey, who's got the crapola over here? Try to draw a tree trunk. I need to stop taking my crapola.
Oh, such a funny man. If you ever are on YouTube and you look up a thing that he did called The Government Can, it'll make you laugh and cry at the same time. Tim Hawkins, 51 today. Nora Jones is 40. And Anna Nalick is 35. Though some of the people who celebrate the 30th day of March is their birthday, if this happens to be your birthday...
Hi, we're the four freshmen, and we just want to say... Happy birthday to you.
It's the story of Dr. Kildare as it was originally broadcast some 67 years ago today, March 30th, 1951. I'm Wyatt Cox. You're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station.
Balance of Nature's fruits and veggies in a capsule.
I believe that your company has the answer, because I've been through cancer treatment and knowing what it does to the body, and oh my, you know, if that's all that medical science has to offer, there must be a better way. And I think the better way is knowing what to eat and getting it. I do notice that I have less inflammation. I feel like when I'm taking Balance of Nature, I'm getting fruits and vegetables more than what I would ordinarily get. I like when I open up the bottles. You can really smell the fruits and vegetables. I mean, I know I'm getting fruits and vegetables.
When you call, use discount code USA, and we'll take 20% off any first preferred order of Balance of Nature and have it shipped to you free. Call 1-800-246-8751. That's 1-800-246-8751. Or go online to balanceofnature.com and use discount code USA.
I know you've heard me talking about the amazing pillows made by MyPillow. Now, the creator, Mike Lindell, is a sleep genius. Everything he creates revolves around making sure you get the best sleep of your life. That's why he created the new Giza Dreams bed sheets. He started by using the world's best cotton called Giza. It's only grown in a region between the Sahara Desert, the Mediterranean Sea, and the Nile River. It's ultra-soft, breathable, and extremely durable. The Giza Dreams sheet set also includes two full 21-inch pillowcases that will fit over any pillow and deep pocket sheets that will fit over any mattress. The first night you sleep on these sheets, you'll never want to sleep on anything else. When you crawl under the bed, it's going to feel like you're sleeping in a five-star resort. Just go to MyPillow.com, click on the Giza Dreams sheets special, and use the promo code USA. You'll get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off and free shipping. Don't forget to enter promo code USA when you go to MyPillow.com.
This is a national health alert from the healthcare hotline. Are you on Medicare and or have private insurance and suffer from back pain? MD Topical has a solution for you. Today, you can qualify to receive a pain-relieving treatment, such as a comfortable back brace or a customized pain treatment at little or no cost. Call MD Topical toll-free now, 877-875-5909. It just takes a couple of minutes to qualify for these amazing treatments that have helped thousands of people with severe pain. Your personalized pain treatment will be delivered directly to your door. Call MD Topical toll-free, 877-875-5909, or go to mdtopical.com and get started on your road to a pain-free life. Call MD Topical toll-free, 877-875-5909, or go to mdtopical.com.
You're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station. Now an episode of the story of Dr. Kildare as it was originally broadcast Friday, March 30th, 1951, 67 years ago today.
The story of Dr. Kildare.
Whatsoever house I enter, there will I go for the benefit of the sick. And whatsoever things I see or hear concerning the life of men, I will keep silence thereon, counting such things to be held as sacred trust. I will exercise my art solely for the cure of my...
The story of Dr. Kildare, starring Lou Ayres and Lionel Barrymore. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer brought you those famous motion pictures. Now this exciting, heartwarming series is heard on radio. Now the story of Dr. Kildare, starring Lou Ayres as Dr. Kildare and Lionel Barrymore as Dr. Gillespie.
Excuse me, Dr. Kildare.
Joan?
I thought you were alone. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Come in, Joan. Miss Quinn, I'd like to have you meet the head of our diagnostic clinic, Dr. Gillespie.
Oh, how do you do, Dr. Gillespie? I've heard Dr. Kildare mention your name many times.
Miss Quinn, my pleasure. You're new here, aren't you?
Mm-hmm. My second day.
Now, don't tell me. Don't tell me. I know every nurse's cap in the country. Now, let me... Chicago Orthopedic.
Why, that's exactly right, Dr. Gillespie.
Welcome to Blair General, Miss Quinn. We're happy to have you.
We certainly are.
I know I'm going to love it here. Thank you both. I'll be waiting for you, Dr. Kildare.
Wonderful girl.
Jimmy?
Hmm?
She's very pretty.
Oh, Miss Quinn. Yes, isn't she?
Yes. Outside of Diana Verner, I'd say she's just about the prettiest nurse I'd ever seen around this hospital.
I'm lucky to have her on my ward.
Isn't Diana working with you anymore?
She's on a 2-week vacation. Joan's her replacement.
Yeah, she certainly is. Jimmy, I've been thinking about your future.
My future? Now, what brought that up?
A young doctor... in a large hospital, should be very careful of things.
Things, Dr. G? What kind of things?
Well, things. He should never find himself in a position where people might question his personal life.
Oh, I agree. Absolutely right.
The best way to avoid such a situation is to get married. Now, you and Diana Verner have gone together for some time. She's a wonderful girl.
I agree. You don't have to sell me on Diana.
Yeah. I am much older than you are, Jimmy. And, I'm not making myself very clear. I want you to...
Excuse me. Kildare speaking. Oh, yes, yes. Oh, is it that late? Well, I'll be right there. Yes, Joan. Sorry, Doctor, I've got to run.
But, Jimmy, I want to talk to you about this.
Well,
let's have lunch together.
I'm afraid I'm tied up for lunch. Some other time, huh? See you later, Doctor.
Joan. Yeah.
Well, Joan, this is our cafeteria at Blair General. How do you like it?
Oh, I'm so glad you brought me here, Jimmy. This is a wonderful hospital.
I'm very glad you're here. Very glad. May I have the sugar?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Jimmy, I was never so happy. I could just kiss you.
Well, don't do it now. People might not understand.
Why, Jimmy, what do you mean?
You know very well what I mean. Dr. Gillespie's sitting over there glaring at us. And every intern in the place is having indigestion on account of you.
Well, I'm with you, and all of that will stop pretty soon. I know it will. Jimmy, I'm so glad. I'm so honestly glad to be working with you. I'm sort of protected from things like that.
What was it in Chicago, Joan?
Oh,
The usual. A patient who was in the hospital for a rather long convalescence thought he'd fallen in love with me, and, well, I just couldn't stay on.
You didn't have to leave. If I know you, Joan, you didn't encourage him.
No, not purposely. Oh, Jimmy, ever since I was in high school and won my first beauty contest, I've known how to lower my eyes at just the right time.
Oh, yeah.
Or look sad or winsome or whatever the occasion demanded. It's become sort of reflex. I don't know, I'm doing it sometimes and things happen that I don't intend to happen.
I see.
Well, it was fun then, teasing. But now I'm a grown woman, graduate nurse. I don't want a lot of men falling all over themselves for me. There's only one man I want.
You're using your eyes on me right now.
Hmm? Oh, darn it, there I go. You see how it is. Help me, Jimmy, prescribe something.
I'll tell you what. To play safe, and so you won't lose your touch, you just do it when you're around me. The rest of the time, be on your guard.
Thank you, Doctor. I'll do my best.
Leonard Gillespie, as I live and breathe.
Hello, Molly. You're pretty as a picture.
Are you up here to ask for a new nurse?
New nurse? Oh, no, nothing like that.
Oh. Leonard, you haven't been fighting with Dr. Carew again and want me to smooth it over for
you. Oh, no. Carew and I get along just fine.
Good. Well, I know you aren't here to ask me to marry you, so there's just one other thing. Come on, out with it. I'm a busy woman. What about Dr. Kildare?
Molly, I'm worried about that new nurse he's got, the one who's replacing Diana Werner.
Joan Quinn? What's wrong with her?
I met her for the first time today. I don't like the way she looks at him.
You mean you came up here just to tell me you don't like the way a nurse looks at a doctor?
It's the way Kildare's looking at her.
Oh, you've lost your mind.
No, Molly. What I'm trying to say is that she's, she's an awful lot of girl.
Oh.
You should have seen him at lunch today. People are beginning to talk already.
Oh. I see.
Yeah.
Well, let them talk. Joan's only going to be with Dr. Kildare until Diana Werner returns. That's just 2 weeks, and then she'll have a regular assignment.
I know, but give a woman like that 2 days with a man like Kildare, and he's liable to wind up married to her.
Well, you've always said you thought Dr. Kildare should marry.
Ah, but hang it all, Molly. Diana Werner's the girl for Jimmy Kildare, not Joan Quinn. She's got a vampire look to her.
Maybe she has, but she's still a good nurse.
Ah, good nurse. You ought to be in a chorus line.
And Dr. Kildare certainly thinks so.
She's out for him, Molly. You've got to transfer that female Rasputin right away.
I don't have to do anything of the sort. There's my buzzer. I've got to get over to pathology right away.
Molly, I wish you'd look at this from my point of view.
Joan is a capable nurse, and Dr. Kildare's more than satisfied with her. No, Leonard. I will not transfer her, and that is final.
Capable nurse. Blech. A Delilah, if I ever saw one. Bow.
Oh, I thought I had Miss Bird's office. This is Dr. Carew.
She's out. This is Gillespie.
Oh, Dr. Gillespie. I was just calling to see if Miss Bird had a nurse to spare. They're short in orthopedic ward.
Are they? It's too bad.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
As the head of this hospital, sometimes I just don't know what to do. They're complaining, and Miss Bird isn't in, and I...
Oh, Dr. Carew, I know just the nurse for that ward. She's brilliant, capable, efficient.
Really?
Yeah.
Who?
Her name is Joan Quinn. Specialized in orthopedic work in Chicago. Brand new here.
Do you know if she's been assigned yet?
Well, yeah, just temporarily on Kildare's ward. But she could be unassigned.
Oh, I couldn't do that.
You could if you knew the circumstances.
Circumstances? What do you mean?
I'll be right down to your office and explain in detail.
Dr. Carew, I want to know why Miss Quinn has been transferred to orthopedic ward.
Well, now, Dr. Kildare, she she is a specialist in orthopedic work.
But I made a request that she be assigned to me.
Yes, I know about that.
Oh, really? And how did you know?
Well, I heard about it, and I thought that I... Oh, Dr. Gillespie, just the man I wanted to see.
Hello, Jimmy. What is it, Carew?
Dr. Kildare has been asking me about Miss Quinn.
Well, I think I'll be running along.
Just a minute. Did you have anything to do with all this?
Why, Jimmy, I don't have anything to do with the assignment of nurses. That's Molly Bird's province.
I know. Only she told me she didn't have anything to do with this case.
You might as well know. Dr. Gillespie and I decided it would be better for you if Miss Quinn were placed in another part of the hospital.
We thought she might distract you from your work, Jimmy.
I see. And you both were aware of all the trouble I went to have her work for me.
Well, Jimmy, people were starting to talk about you two.
And so you just stepped in and straightened matters out, right?
Well, we did it for your own good.
I see. Well, if I weren't already aware of Miss Quinn's charms, I'm certainly aware of them now, thanks to you. And if I felt they were interfering with my work in any way, I would have taken steps. I think I'm a mature enough person to make my own decisions in these matters. Or maybe you don't think so around here.
I don't think we did the right thing, Dr. Gillespie.
Yes, blots.
Well.
Oh, well yourself.
You had every right to become angry, and you know it, Dr. Gillespie.
Parker, if there's one thing I don't want, it's a lecture from you. Now go out and clean a test tube and leave me alone.
You're going to have to apologize to him sooner or later. Might as well be sooner.
I waited in his office for 3 hours this afternoon, and he never showed up.
Well, you just have to catch him when you can.
Now, she's caught him, all right. That nurse, she's an enchantress. She's a lure, a vixen. She came here from Chicago with a mission. I see it all now.
What are you talking about?
I never considered for one moment that Jimmy would ever leave Blair General.
Dr. Kildare leaving?
An hour ago, I learned something while I was waiting in his office. There was a letter on his desk.
A letter on his desk? You mean you read his mail?
I certainly did. It was from a Chicago hospital offering him a post there.
No.
Yes, Parker, yes. And I believe we just lost the best young doctor in the country.
We return to the story of Dr. Kildare in just a moment.
From March 30th, 1951, the story of Dr. Kildare on Classic Radio Theater. Coming up in 4 minutes, we will have the news of the day from 67 years ago today and the conclusion of the story of Dr. Kildare.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrim for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Ayres, and I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
Oh my gosh, you've heard me talking about MyPillow and how it helps you get a great night's sleep. Well, Mike Lindell, the sleep savant, has come up with something even better to help you get a great night's sleep. He created these new Giza Dreams bed sheets. Now, he started by using the world's best cotton called Giza. It's only grown in a region between the Sahara, the Mediterranean, and the Nile. Now, it's ultra soft, breathable, and durable. That's one of the most important things. I mean, it's comfortable and it doesn't last, what sense does it make? But it's really durable. Now, the Giza Dream Sleep Set also includes two full 21-inch wide pillowcases that will fit over any My Pillow and deep pocket sheets that will fit over any mattress. Now, the first night you sleep on these sheets, you'll never want to sleep on anything else. I've got these on my bed right now. When I crawl into bed, it feels like I'm sleeping at a five-star motel. Now, if you go right now to MyPillow.com, click on the Giza Dream Sheets Special, and use promo code USA, you're going to get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off, free shipping. But enter promo code USA when you go to MyPillow.com. And by the way, that promo code works on just about anything on the MyPillow.com website. So check it out. But the Giza Dream Sleep Set, you will love these. Click on the special. Use promo code USA to get 30% off at MyPillow.com.
Now you can fly anywhere in the world and pay discount prices on your airline tickets. Book a flight today to London, Paris, Madrid, or anywhere else you want to go. And pay a lot less guaranteed. Call the International Travel Department right now at Low Cost Airlines.
800-215-5141. 800-215-5141. That's 800-215-5141.
If you enjoy our classic radio theater broadcasts and want to start building a collection of your own, go to classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. There you'll find links to great classic radio collections on CD, along with links to great reading on classic radio, plus classic radio theater on demand. Check out our webpage, available now at classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. And enjoy. You're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station, an episode of The Story of Dr. Kildare, as it was originally broadcast Friday, March 30th, 1951. In the newspapers of that Friday, 67 years ago today, these were some of the headlines. Dateline U.S. 8th Army Headquarters Korea Leif Erickson, writing for the Associated Press, reports the 8th Army Command believes the Chinese and Korean Reds right now are capable of launching an offensive in greater power than the communists have yet tried. In factors of weather and timing, the Chinese command could choose no better period for a massive drive than the first 3 weeks of April. Any belief that the Korean War may end by political settlement because United Nations forces now have driven near the 38th parallel is strictly wishful thinking and based on false conclusions in the opinion of officers on the spot. All evidence, according to Erickson, is to the contrary. Meanwhile, from Tokyo, communist mortar and machine gun fire crashed into the northern outskirts of Chuncheon today on Korea's central front, 7 miles south of the 38th parallel. The sudden flare-up of enemy action indicates that Chinese forces had advanced their line as far south of a previous central front defense line, just half a mile below the parallel. Dateline Hollywood, Judy Holliday won the coveted Best Actress Oscar last night for her brassy portrayal of a dumb blonde in Born Yesterday, and Jose Ferrer won the Best Actor Award for his role as the big-nosed hero of Cyrano de Bergerac. Best Picture of the Year was the popular All About Eve. Josephine Ho walked off with the Best Supporting Actress Award for her role as the lady who saw a rabbit in Harvey. George Sanders won the Best Supporting Actor Oscar for his role as a cynical critic in All About Eve. Dateline Washington, President Truman praised the work of the Senate Crime Committee yesterday, but said he has no intention of removing former New York Mayor William O'Dwyer as U.S. Ambassador to Mexico. While he gave Senate investigators great credit for focusing public attention on organized crime, Truman asserted that his administration has been waging war on racketeers for years. He added that the main responsibility for stamping out crime rests with state and local authorities and the public itself. Dateline Washington, the Senate Crime Committee won a 30-day lease on life yesterday as its year-long disclosures of lawlessness and corruption spurred an unprecedented nationwide drive against racketeers and corrupt public officials. At the same time, the committee voted to press new contempt charges against New York gambler Frank Costello for his failure to supply a statement of his net worth. It dropped previous contempt charges against the New Yorker after deciding that he had purged himself by appearing before the group in New York. Meanwhile, Senate crime probers digging into a reputed Cleveland gambling syndicate yesterday encountered another bulky witness that makes five of them who will be called back for one more chance to spill their stories and escape possible contempt of court charges. Dateline Riverside, California, stocky Negro Air Force sergeant charged yesterday with murder and kidnapping in the desert slaying of a young man and wife. The complaint accused Sergeant Lawrence J. Walker, 20, of fatally shooting Richard Cook, 18, as the latter stood beside his car, and of kidnapping and shooting Cook's pretty wife, Doris, also 18, at an isolated rock quarry. Dateline Gary, Indiana, Mrs. Hilda Burton, chairman of the Women's Citizens Committee, which has led a fight against crime in this steel city, filed her claim yesterday for mayor on the Democratic ticket. She's a school teacher. There are seven other Democratic candidates. Dateline Paris, the three Western power delegations at the Big Four deputies meeting sought a unanimous answer last night to the new Russian proposals on what to do in an effort to ease world tensions. The Westerners appealed to their foreign ministers for more instructions. Dateline Denver, seven picnickers rescued yesterday from their snowbound automobile where they huddled two nights and a day, cold and without food except for lunch leftovers, which went to the two children. Dateline Wingham, Ontario, William Kelly's horse is loaded. Seems Kelly has a farm near this western Ontario town, brought home a box of 22 caliber rifle bullets Wednesday, put them on a windowsill in the barn. The horse promptly munched about a dozen. So far, no report. Those some of the day's top news stories as reported in the newspapers of Friday, March 30th, 1951, on your radio. The story of Dr. Kildare, which continues now on Classic Radio Theater.
Now we continue with the story of Dr. Kildare, starring Lou Ayres as Dr. Kildare and Lionel Barrymore as Dr. Gillespie.
Come in.
Oh, Jimmy.
Joan.
Sorry, Dr. Kildare.
Come in, Joan.
I was transferred because they didn't want me working with you. Isn't that right?
Oh, I don't know. They shift people around here all the time.
Oh, no, that's not true, Jimmy. Because we had lunch together and went out one night and because you requested me to work with you, it looks bad for you, doesn't it?
A few people have probably made some comments here and there. They don't mean a thing.
Oh, please don't try to make it easy for me, Jimmy. They must mean something if you're going to leave the hospital.
Oh? Just a minute.
But I have to be perfectly honest with you, Jimmy. The way it sounded to me, it seemed as if you were being asked to resign.
Is that so?
Well, I didn't believe it, of course. I didn't want to, but all the other nurses have suddenly started treating me as if I'd committed some crime. It isn't true that you're being fired, is it?
Huh? Oh, no, Joan, I'm not being fired. Here's what I was looking for.
Oh, what is it?
Just a letter of mine. Thought for a minute it might have been missing. I should never have left it on my desk.
What am I going to do, Jimmy? Should I go to Dr. Carew or should I quit, or what?
Joan, believe me, you don't have to leave this time. What's happened is not your fault. It's my job to do something, and I know just what I'm going to do.
Wayman, just a minute.
Yes, Dr. Gillespie.
Didn't I just see you come out of Dr. Kildare's office? What are you doing with all those books and things?
Carrying them. And if I stay in here much longer, Doc, I might drop him. I'm doing a favor for a friend.
What friend?
Dr. Gillespie, I'm afraid that at the moment that I am not at liberty to divulge that. I promise my friend.
You're not at liberty, huh? Come now, Wayman, what is it?
Another minute, Doctor. I'll drop these books, so help me.
Well, tell me all about it now, and you won't have to stand there.
Here they go! See what you made me do.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, Wayman. Here, let me help you pick them up.
No, thanks, Doctor. I'll do it all right myself.
I insist on helping you. After all, I... Well, these books belong to Dr. Kildare.
I'm sorry you looked, Doctor.
So am I, Wayman. So am I. Tell me, where are you supposed to take these things?
To his car. And there's a lot of other stuff, too. Microscopes and things.
I see. Then he's made up his mind.
Look, you can't let him go, Doc. He's too nice a guy.
A lot of people agree with you, Wayman. A lot of people.
The story of Dr. Kildare from March 30th, 1951, 67 years ago today. I'm Wyatt Cox. Thanks for tuning into this Saturday edition of Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrim for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Ayres, and I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
Tired of overpaying for the little blue pill? What if you could get the exact same results for just a fraction of the price, guaranteed? Well, now you can with sildenafil, the active ingredient in the blue pill. With 20 milligram generic sildenafil tablets, you get the exact same results for less than $2 per pill, and again, the results are guaranteed. That's right, absolutely guaranteed results for a fraction of the cost of the little blue pill. So give your wallet a break and call us toll-free at 800-362-6091 to get your generic sildenafil delivered discreetly to your door. And of course, while saving hundreds of dollars, you'll also be saving time by saying goodbye to those long, embarrassing pharmacy lines once and for all. Again, just call 800-362-6091 and get your generic sildenafil with a 100% money-back guarantee. Getting your pills doesn't get any easier or cheaper than this, so call 800-362-6091 now.
It's amazing but true. When it comes to one of America's biggest household expenditures, healthcare, a lot of people think they've got no choice. People are used to thinking we have to do it this way, but they don't. Yes, you have the freedom to choose an alternative with your healthcare. It's MediShare, and it costs way less than the alternatives. The typical family saves $500 a month, not a year. A month. And if you're single, this can save you a lot too. And let's face it, a big reason MediShare is 400,000 people strong, it just works. They've shared over $3 billion in medical bills, so they can help share your needs too. Joining MediShare for so many people is one of those things that makes you say, why didn't I do this before? So yes, the time has come for something better. Look into joining MediShare and see why so many people are opting out of the old way and into the new. Why not look into this? Just call 855-90-PSALM. That's 855-90-PSALM. 855-90-PSALM.
Thanks for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station on this Saturday. And coming up tomorrow at this time, the CBS Radio Workshop, a very delightful story. Very humorous and very touching. It's entitled A Dog's Life. Tony Schwartz decides to adopt a dog and finds there's more to it than it first appears. This was originally broadcast 62 years ago, March 31st, 1957. And remember, you can always find our podcasts at classicradio.stream. That's our webpage, not .com, but .stream. Classicradio.stream. Now the conclusion of the story of Dr. Kildare, Lou Ayres, Lionel Barrymore starring, from 67 years ago, March 30th, 1951.
Jimmy, my boy, come in, come in.
You sent for me, Dr. Gillespie?
Well, it's sort of a slow afternoon, and I thought it might be nice for the two of us to sit around and chat.
They're not too slow up at my end of the hospital.
Jimmy, let's get to the point. You see sitting before you a four-star, gold-plated, embossed example of a meddling old fool.
Oh, that's pretty harsh self-condemnation, Doctor.
Well deserved, Jimmy. I must confess that I was the one who had Joan Quinn transferred out of your department.
Yes, I know.
You've always been my favorite doctor. Not only mine, but a lot of people's. Well, you're the apple of Dr. Carew's eye.
Really?
Yes, indeed. He's admired the way you've stuck with this hospital through thick and thin, through fat days and lean days.
Through the good years and the bad years.
Exactly. And he was saying it was getting close to the time when you should be rewarded for your faithfulness.
Thank him for me.
And as for myself, Jimmy, I've always looked forward to your taking over my post on that sad day when they set me out to pasture.
Dr. G, I suspect you'll still be at this desk 30 years.
Oh, no, Jimmy. No. Confidentially, I don't think it'll be long now.
Oh?
My usefulness is about over, you know. And, well, there's no other doctor in this country I'd rather hand the reins over to than you.
I'm deeply moved, Dr. Gillespie. But my own plans for the future are a little uncertain at present. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to return to my work.
Oh, sure, Jimmy. Duty before anything else. We'll talk again later. Gillespie, Carew. Didn't work. He's pretty burned up about everything.
Oh, this is terrible. Terrible?
Terrible. Worse than that. In a couple of days, you're going to be less one doctor, and I'm going to be out one friend.
Well, isn't there something we can do?
Well, if there is, I haven't thought of it yet. And frankly, right at the moment, I feel worse than I've felt in years.
What's the matter, Joan?
They sent me up for you. Can you come to 3B right away?
Certainly. What is it?
Dr. Gillespie just collapsed in his office.
How did it happen, Dr. Carew?
Well, I don't really know. I came in and found him on the floor. I had some ward attendants bring him in here.
Mm-hmm.
I started to examine him, but he insisted that you look after him.
Oh dear. I don't think I'll live another hour.
Oh, my.
Jimmy, is that you?
I'm right here, Dr. G. Your pulse is way up.
Must be 140.
That's exactly what it is. You have a temperature and your face is flushed. Tell me what happened.
He became dizzy. He had spots before his eyes.
I can tell him, Carew. I can tell him.
Oh.
After all, it happened to me.
Oh, don't get excited, Dr. Gillespie.
Everything went black.
Yes, black.
And the last thing I remember was falling out of that chair.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any idea what it might be?
Jimmy, I can't figure it out. I guess I'm just overworked.
Yes, he's overworked.
Jimmy, I don't want any other doctor looking after me. Promise me that you'll stay with me until I get through this.
Yes, do promise.
I promise, Dr. James.
Good boy.
I guess I'll just have to run you through a whole series of clinical tests. I'll get started on it right away.
We did it, Carew. We did it.
If we can get him to stay now, we can get him to stay forever.
How's Dr. Gillespie, Dr. Kildare?
He's resting comfortably, Parker.
Oh, I don't know what I'd do if anything happened to that man.
Tell me, Parker, was the doctor in his laboratory about a half an hour ago?
Well, yes. As a matter of fact, he was.
Mm-hmm. Did you by any chance see what he was doing there?
Oh, well, no. No, not exactly.
Think hard, Parker.
Well, I think I did hear him mumble something about digitalis.
Oh, digitalis, huh?
Digitalis.
Thank you, Parker. Thank you very much.
Will he be all right, Dr. Kildare?
Parker, I think he'll be up and around before you know it. Dr. G?
Hello, Jimmy.
Oh, how do you feel now?
Pretty weak. I'm afraid I'm in serious shape.
Well, I hate to tell you this, but after all, you're a doctor and you should be able to take it.
Take what?
Well, you're suffering from an unusual malady, one known as acute snoopitis.
Acute snoopitis?
Yes, the symptoms are bulging of the eyes, enlargement of the ears, and elongation of the nose, not to mention an inability at controlling speech.
Why, Jimmy, how could you?
And as for that fever and fast pulse, you took digitalis to give you those symptoms.
I did?
You did.
Well, what sort of treatment do you prescribe, Doctor?
Something to stop the disease once and for all. Immediate injection of the truth in the form of certain facts to counteract certain fictions.
Well, I guess I'm ready for the first injection.
I guess you are. Fiction. That Joan Quinn and I are emotionally interested in each other. In fact, we are just old friends. I was the best man at her wedding. She married a medical student 6 months ago, and those books and personal equipment I was moving out were for him, to save him some money.
Say, I'm beginning to feel better already.
Fiction. I am going to leave Blair General Hospital. Fact, I am not. I received a letter from another hospital, considered it for a day, and rejected it. If you'd only looked further down into that pile of letters on my desk, you'd have found my reply turning down the job.
Jimmy, I confess, you were right.
Hmm.
You know, I think I'm just about cured.
Now, wait a minute. Another injection. Fiction, you are getting out of bed. Fact, you are not.
Now,
lie down, Dr. G. With a nurse and the head of this hospital as witnesses, you placed me in complete charge of your case. Now, whether you know it or not, you are run down from overwork. A few days in bed will do you a world of good. I'm signing the order myself.
Oh, now, Jimmy.
Don't now, Jimmy. And I'll tell you another thing. Your nurse is going to be Joan Quinn.
Oh, really? Well, now, say, you know, maybe you've got something. Maybe I do need a rest.
And now, once again, the story of Dr. Kildare, starring Lou Ayres as Dr. Kildare and Lionel Barrymore as Dr. Gillespie.
How's Dr. Gillespie, Parker?
Oh, Joan Quinn has him purring like a kitten. Uh-oh, well, there's his buzzer. She asked me to look after him for a few minutes.
I think I'll look in on him with you.
Ooh, hello, cutie.
Huh?
Oh, it's you.
Oh, I didn't think you were calling me cutie.
Now, what are you hiding, Dr. Gillespie?
I'm not hiding anything.
Oh, yes, you are now. Come out with it. Come on.
All right.
Well, it's a slingshot.
Made out of a piece of rubber tubing.
Well, a man has to do something or you go crazy here in bed. I'm a pretty good shot, too. I can hit the doorknob 4 times out of 5.
What's your ammunition?
Pills.
Dr. Gillespie.
Well, just for that, I think I'm going to keep you in bed 3 more days.
You wouldn't.
Oh, yes, I would. Goodbye and pleasant dreams, Dr. G.
I'll be back, Doctor. Goodbye. Oh! Dr. Gillespie!
I've been waiting all day to do that.
You have just heard the story of Dr. Kildare, starring Lou Ayres and Lionel Barrymore. This program was written by E. Jack Newman and John Michael Hayes and directed by Joe Bigelow. Original music was composed and conducted by Walter Schumann. Supporting cast included Virginia Gregg, Ted Osborne, Ed Max, Eleanor Audley, and Betty Lou Gerson. Dick Joy speaking.
There you have it, the story of Dr. Kildare from March 30th, 1951, 67 years ago today. Thanks for spending part of your Saturday with us here on Classic Radio Theater. Email classicradiotheater@gmail.com. I mentioned earlier that you can find our podcasts on demand at classicradio.stream, along with more information on classic radio collecting and some of what we do when we're away from this microphone. Our podcasts are always available through iTunes, Spreaker, the iHeartRadio app. All you have to do is search USA Classic Radio Theater. And I'm Wyatt Cox. Hey, thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. Would you do me a huge favor? Would you thank this radio station? Always support the advertisers. And, of course, tell a friend that the great radio shows are back. Classic Radio Theater right here on this, your favorite radio station and the USA Radio Network.
The USA Radio Network presents the greatest radio programs of all time.
Suspense. Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to hear is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Dragnet.
This is Classic Radio Theater.
Gangbusters!
I was a communist for the FBI.
Lights out, everybody.
Now here's your host, Wyatt Cox.
Frank Sinatra stars as Rocky Fortune in the final show of the series from March 30th, 1954, The Boarding House Doublecross.
Frank Sinatra. Transcribed as Rocky Fortune. Frank Sinatra, starring as that footloose and fancy-free young gentleman, Rocky Fortune.
Hi, did I ever tell you about the time I decided to give up my place on Bleakman Street and find a new room? Oh, not that the place was bad, but when they started using my mailbox as a numbers drop, I decided it was time to find a new pad, which I did. The only trouble was the landlady. She wanted to collect the first month's rent in blood. And when I objected, her superintendent tried to terminate my lease on life. Hello? Anybody home? Hey, where's the management?
Right behind you. Put up your hands. Hey,
what is this?
You tell me, bright boy.
I'm looking for a room.
What brought you here?
The sign in the window that says room for rent. Now, would you mind pointing that horse pistol the other way?
What's your name?
Julius LaRosa. What's yours?
You a wise guy?
Listen, Sammy, put down the artillery and let's get the...
Who is it, Lenny?
This joke was wandering around inside, Ma.
The door was open, the sign said room for rent, so I came in.
You want to rent a room.
That's the general idea, Ma.
Put away the gun, Lenny.
Ma, how do you know who this character is?
Put it away.
Thanks, Ma.
We've been having trouble with thieves lately. Lenny thought maybe you was one.
Well, I'm glad you protect your guests. Do you have a room?
We got one vacancy on this floor, third door down.
Can I see it?
This way. $5 a week in advance.
This is a peachy view of the garbage bin.
Take it or leave it.
Well, I'd like to leave it, but I need a flop until I can locate an apartment. I'll take it.
Five.
Wait till I get the vault open, will you? One, two, three, four, five.
No heavy drinking in the rooms. Keep off the second floor. That's where me and Lenny live.
It's a deal. You keep off my floor, and I'll keep off yours.
I ain't joking, mister. You set foot on those stairs, and Lenny's liable to lose his temper. When Lenny loses his temper, he's liable to do anything. Anything. Well, welcome to 55 Bishop Street. My name's Thompson. You call me Ma.
That's touching.
If you go out at night, be careful. This is a tough neighborhood.
I come from a pretty tough neighborhood.
This ain't pretty tough. It's real tough.
Oops. I park my duffel and flop down on the mattress, which is a cross between a sack of cement and the Aberdeen Proving Grounds for light, medium, and heavy tanks. No sooner do I close my eyes than the door opens. In walks a little bald-headed guy about 40 wearing rimless glasses. A Casper Milk Toast if I ever seen one, and I seen several.
What are you doing here?
What do I look like I'm doing? Playing Scrabble? Do you believe in knocking?
Get out of this room.
Oh, you got to get a little bigger before you talk like that to a full-grown man, Buster.
Where are my things? Where's Helen?
I ain't seen your things. And the only Helen I know is Helen of Troy, and she moved to Utica about 3 years ago.
Oh, very funny.
I didn't think it was that good.
It wasn't. Now, see here. I want you out of our room, and I demand to know
something
where...
Something wrong, Mr. Fortune.
This billiard head keeps acting like somebody's in the wrong department.
Mrs. Thompson, what is this man doing in my room?
Who are you?
Who am I? Why, I'm Gerald Kinsey. My wife, Helen, and I have had this room for a week now.
Mister, you're nuts. I ain't never seen you in my life.
Never seen me? I paid you a week's rent this morning. My wife, Helen, was...
I don't know anybody named Helen except Helen of Troy, and she...
He knows.
Come on, Horace. Get out of here.
Oh, are you all out of your minds? What is this?
You heard me, Homer. Vanish.
I demand my wife. I demand...
You demand a belt and a mouth if you don't beat it.
I will now. I'll...
Something wrong, Ma.
We got a stray bedbug. He thinks he lives here.
Lenny. You remember me. Gerald Kinsey. My wife, Helen, and I were...
What keep talking about, Ma?
Lenny.
Look, Zeke. You got the wrong house, maybe, huh?
Wrong house? Why, this is 55 Bishop Street, room one. My wife and I were...
Lenny, show him the door.
Let's go.
I will not go. I demand my wife. I demand my wife.
One, two, and away we go.
Take your hands off of me and I'll...
You owe nothing. Now get out. And if you come back here, I'll kill you, understand? I'll break every bone in your body. Ow! Ow!
I watched Lenny give Gerald a bicep like he was a sack of old feathers, and then I start to unpack. Inside the dresser drawer, I spot a cufflink with the monogrammed initials GK on it. Also, there was some spilled face powder. I put the cufflink in my pocket and lie down on my bed to think things over. I'm just starting to doze off when I hear a sound at the window. So I make like I'm asleep, and I wait. A second later, Gerald slips into the room with a medium-sized paving stone in his mitt. He tiptoes over to the bed and gets ready to drop the concrete on my skull as I mousetrap him.
Hold it. Drop it. Come on, drop it.
Ouch, my arm. You're breaking it.
Drop the Mickey. Now sit down.
Oh, please.
You better start talking, sonny. I'm going to get rough, too.
Who are you?
My name's Rocky Fortune. I just rented this room. They forgot to tell me it was an outpatient clinic for Bellevue.
You're not with them?
With who? I'm not with anybody.
Then you've got to help me.
Give me one convincing reason.
Listen, you've got to believe me, mister. For the past 3 days, my wife and I have lived in this room. This morning, I went out to look for a job. When I came back just now, they rented the room to you. They're just pretending they never saw me. They've done something to my wife. I know they have.
Why should they?
I don't know. They may be in some shady business or something. Maybe she found out about it. But, oh, please, please, you must believe me.
Hold it. Your initials are GK, aren't they?
Why, yes. Gerald Kinsey.
You ever see this cufflink?
Why, that's the one I lost. Helen and I looked all over for it.
It was under the shelving paper in some newspaper in the dresser.
But that should prove I lived here.
It's enough to go on, Gerald.
You see, the whole thing is a plot to...
Shh. Huh? Fortune!
Just a minute. Look, you better use the emergency exit out the window. If Nature Boy finds you in here, he'll take you apart like a jigsaw puzzle.
What'll I do?
I got a friend who's a cop, 21st Precinct, Sergeant Finger.
Huh?
Tell him I sent you and bring him back here quick.
Open up!
Now beat it. Remember, Finger, Sergeant Hamilton J. Finger.
I thought I heard somebody talking in there.
Talking? Oh, that was me. I always talk to myself.
Oh, that's a bad habit.
I never listen to it.
That's a good one. It'll keep you out of trouble.
What kind of trouble did you have in mind?
The kind where they bury you. Remember it.
March 30th, 1954, Rocky Fortune on Classic Radio Theater.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrim for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Aronson. I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
I know you've heard me talking about the amazing pillows made by MyPillow. Now, the creator, Mike Lindell, is a sleep genius. Everything he creates revolves around making sure you get the best sleep of your life. That's why he created the new Giza Dreams bed sheets. He started by using the world's best cotton called Giza. It's only grown in a region between the Sahara Desert, the Mediterranean Sea, and the Nile River. It's ultra soft, breathable, and extremely durable. The Giza Dreams sheet set also includes two full 21-inch pillowcases that will fit over any pillow and deep pocket sheets that will fit over any mattress. The first night you sleep on these sheets, you'll never want to sleep on anything else. When you climb into the bed, it's going to feel like you're sleeping in a five-star resort. Just go to MyPillow.com, click on the Giza Dreams sheet special, and use the promo code USA. You'll get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off and free shipping. Don't forget to enter promo code USA when you go to MyPillow.com.
This is a national health alert from the healthcare hotline. Are you on Medicare and or have private insurance and suffer from back pain? MD Topical has a solution for you. Today, you can qualify to receive a pain-relieving treatment, such as a comfortable back brace or a customized pain treatment at little or no cost. Call MD Topical toll-free now, 888-998-7225. It just takes a couple of minutes to qualify for these amazing treatments that have helped thousands of people with severe pain. Your personalized pain treatment will be delivered directly to your door. Call MD Topical toll-free, 888-998-7225, 888-998-7225, or go to mdtopical.com and get started on your road to a pain-free life. Call MD Topical toll-free, 888-998-7225, 888-998-7225. 998-7225, 888-998-7225.
Thanks for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station. Now more of Rocky Fortune starring Frank Sinatra, the final show of the series, March 30th, 1954.
Lenny goes upstairs and I settle down to wait for Gerald and the gendarmes. After a couple of minutes, I hear the steps creak. cracked the door in time to see Grandma carrying a brown paper bag to the back of the hall. She takes maybe two steps and stops.
You're liable to get your nose caught in the crack of that door, Mr. Fortune.
I could spare a little.
We like the boarder to keep the door closed.
Gee, you and Lenny are a couple of real trusting souls, ain't you?
I told you we've been having sneak thieves.
Can I help you with that paper bag?
Just going out back to put the garbage out. I can manage.
Just trying to be friendly.
Try it with the door closed.
Sure, Ma. I hear Ma go out the back door with a bag of garbage. After about 20 minutes, I hear her close the door and go up the steps again. I figure either she went all the way to the city disposal plant with that stuff, or it wasn't a bag of garbage. After things quiet down, I tiptoe down the hall and open the back door. There's a small yard with a high concrete wall. It's filled with broken bottles, old almanacs, and other valuable stuff. At one end is a small wooden shed big enough for a half a dozen garbage cans with a cheap padlock on the outside. Just in a hunch, I go over to the shed and knock. Anybody home? Now, why would anybody want to put a padlock on the garbage? Anybody here beside you chickens? Okay, we'll just do a little lock picking and have a look. Well, don't tell me the housing authority has this place listed as an apartment. You're Helen, right?
Who are you?
My name's Rocky Fortune. How does that guy rate a knockout like you?
Are you working for Gerald?
More or less. He and I seem to share a room.
Listen, you've got to help me.
Maybe we better close the door, just in case Lenny decides to check on his guests. Why have they got you locked up here?
I don't know. Ma and the big one, Lenny, they must have drugged me or something. You got to tell that to Gerald. They locked me out here. They told me they'd kill me if I made a sound. No kidding, mister.
What are you so scared of me for?
You tell Gerald. I wouldn't want him to think I left him on my own or anything. You know how he gets.
You have been drugged. Now, take it easy, kid. We'll have you out of here in no time, as soon as I figure out a way.
Believe me, don't you? I didn't run away from Gerald. Honest, I didn't.
Did you want to?
We had a big fight this morning. But I didn't mean what I said. It's those people, Ma and Lenny. They put me out here.
All right, come on. Let's get out of here. The fragrance from these garbage cans is a little bit too much. Uh-oh.
What is it?
That was the back door to the house. Here comes Lenny and Grandma.
You'd better hide.
Where? In my pocket?
The garbage can.
Smart girl. Okay, put the lid on.
Hey, turn on the air conditioning, will you?
I'm feeling a little bit like a rotten pimento in an undersized olive when it dawns on me that Lenny's going to notice that the lock has been opened. He does.
We out here, Ma?
I just brought her some food.
The lock is open.
I locked it.
It didn't open itself. You gotta be careful.
I told you I locked it.
We better go in.
Food okay, dearie?
Yes.
You better finish it. We're getting you out of here in about 15 minutes.
Out?
Your husband was snooping around. Things might get a little too hot.
Where will you take me?
Oh, I know a nice quiet spot where nobody will look in a million years. I gotta borrow a car. As soon as I get it, we move out. Come on, Ma.
You better take the full garbage cans out front for the collection, Lenny.
What's today?
Tuesday. We got a load of stuff.
Okay.
I'll stay here and watch Mrs. Kinsey.
Here's the gun. I'll just throw this one out first. What you got in here, old lead?
For a couple of minutes, I die while Big Lenny rolls me out to the front of the house to be picked up by a gent from the sanitation department. As I feel myself lifted into the truck, I decide I'll keep quiet till Lenny gets back to the house. It's then that I hear the machine that grinds the stuff.
Okay, Charlie, toss up that next can. What's the matter, Charlie? You forget to eat your crispy crunchies? Come on, let's have it.
Hey, I see what you mean. Now, let's get the cover off this one and take a look. Hey!
Pardon me, Sam. Is this the subway to Jackson Heights?
What are you doing in that can?
Can? Holy mackerel, I thought I was in a subway car. Give me a hand, will you, Sam?
Yeah, sure.
Are you nuts, Buster?
I guess I am, Sam. Would anybody in his right mind get into a garbage can by mistake? I'll see you around. I shake a few breadcrumbs out of my hair and climb off the truck. I sneak back into the house and make for my room. I get there and hear voices inside.
I told you to stay away from here.
I want my wife, Lenny, and I'll kill you if you don't tell me where she's hiding.
Go ahead. Pull the trigger. You haven't got the guts to kill anybody.
It won't be the first time.
It may be the last.
Let go of my throat. Rocky, hit him.
A pleasure, pal.
Is he out?
Like a busted street lamp.
I guess you saved my life.
How come you didn't get the cops?
I got a gun instead. I was determined I'd handle it myself.
Somehow you just don't seem the type. Anyway, I located your ever-loving wife.
Helen? Where?
They got her stashed in a wooden garbage shed in the back.
No, I'll get her.
You stay here and keep the gun on Loverboy in case he recovers from that belt I gave him. Oh. I'll get Helen.
Okay, maybe that's best.
And keep an eye out for Ma. I don't think she's going to like us. I leave Gerald and Lenny in my room and slip on my way out to the shed. I do another hairpin job on the lock and open it up. Helen's sitting on a stack of old newspapers waiting. Helen?
Rocky, you all right?
Yeah, except for a slight tinge of city dump number 5. You ready to get out of the shoebox?
Yes, but what about Lenny?
Lenny's in on his face in my room, and your husband's holding a heater on him.
Gerald? Is here?
Uh-huh.
I see. Puts a slightly different color on things.
You don't look very happy.
I'm not.
What's wrong?
It's none of your business.
Now, look, baby, I almost got myself bumped off getting you out of this trap. Now, level with me.
I'll level, Rocky, but at you, not with you. Get him up.
What is this, Kill Fortune Day in Brooklyn? Where did you get the artillery?
I had it.
I don't get it.
You will. Turn around.
So, you ain't exactly the damsel in distress I figured you for.
Look, button brain, for reasons of my own, I'm not interested in meeting my dear husband right now. I told Ma and Lenny that he was an escaped convict holding me prisoner. I talked them into hiding me out here and pretending they'd never seen me.
How did you manage that?
Little money can make people do very noble things. No more talk now. This won't hurt a bit. I'll just...
Hold it, Helen! Drop the gun! You keep away from it, Fortune. Okay. Ma, into the shed.
You can't do this. Lenny needs a doctor.
I'm doing it. Lenny will come to in an hour or so. I just kicked him once or twice.
Oh, you're a nice kid.
We're even, Fortune. You saved me. I saved you.
Shall we dance?
The only ones who are going to dance are me and my sweet little double-crossing wife.
Gerald, I swear I didn't double-cross you. The old woman and her son, they found out about the jewels. They locked me out here and tried to make me give them up.
That's a lie. You told us your husband took dope and beat you. You asked us to help you get away from him.
That sounds more like my little girl.
She's lying, Gerald. They kidnapped me.
Sure. Where's the stuff?
I hid it.
I'll bet you did. Well, find it.
It's in the ash can. Here.
Yeah. Is this all the stuff from the Rensselaer job?
It's all there, Gerald.
It better be. Because you and I are going for a little journey. And you know how it upsets me when somebody tries to pull a fast one on me.
It's all there.
Okay, Fortune. You and Ma, here are lucky. I'm going to give you a chance to stay alive for a while longer. Because you've been so good. Come on, baby. We're going.
You ain't going anyplace, mister.
Well, look who woke up. Step aside, big boy.
Not till I finished that little job on you that I started a while back.
Lenny, don't do it. She isn't worth it. It was a trick. They're both thieves.
I ain't interested in what they are and what they ain't. I'm going to take your pot, Baldy, and then I'm going to work on your pal here.
I warn you, Lenny. I'll shoot you.
You don't scare me.
Lenny, don't. Please, mister, he's still groggy. He don't know what he's doing.
Tell him to step aside.
Lenny, don't do it.
Gonna give you something to remember.
Lenny! Lenny! Oh, no.
Keep away from him, Ma.
Now you're a murderer, too, or isn't that news?
Shut up. Helen, take Ma into the house and lock her in a cellar.
What are you gonna do?
Never mind that. Get going. Somebody might have heard those shots.
Come on, Ma. Jerry, there's a cop standing out at the end of the alley.
Is he coming?
No, he's just looking around.
He heard the shots. Hurry up, get going.
Let's go.
And don't try anything. I got 50 grand worth of stuff here.
I won't.
Okay, Fortune. Help me get this stiff into one of those empty cans.
Suppose I don't.
I'll kill you.
I'll help.
Ready? Now. cover on.
The conclusion of Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune for March 30th, 1954 comes up in 4 minutes. I'm Wyatt Cox, and you're listening to Classic Radio Theater.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrin for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Ayres, and I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
Oh my gosh, you've heard me talking about MyPillow and how it helps you get a great night's sleep. Well, Mike Lindell, the sleep savant, has come up with something even better to help you get a great night's sleep. He created these new Giza Dreams bed sheets. Now, he started by using the world's best cotton called Giza. It's only grown in a region between the Sahara, the Mediterranean, and the Nile. Now, it's ultra soft, breathable, and durable. That's one of the most important things. I mean, if it's comfortable and it doesn't last, what sense does it make? But it's really durable. Now, the Giza Dream Sleep Set also includes two full 21-inch wide pillowcases that will fit over any MyPillow and deep pocket sheets that will fit over any mattress. Now, the first night you sleep on these sheets, you'll never want to sleep on anything else. Got these on my bed right now. When I crawl into bed, it feels like I'm sleeping at a five-star motel. Now, if you go right now to MyPillow.com, click on the Giza Dream Sheets Special, and use promo code USA, you're going to get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off, free shipping. But enter promo code USA when you go to MyPillow.com. And by the way, that promo code works on just about anything on the MyPillow.com website. So check it out. But the Giza Dream Sleep Set, you will love these. Click on the special. Use promo code USA to get 30% off at MyPillow.com.
Now you can fly anywhere in the world and pay discount prices on your airline tickets. Book a flight today to London, Paris, Madrid, or anywhere else you want to go. And pay a lot less guaranteed. Call the International Travel Department right now at Low Cost Airlines.
800-215-5141. 800-215-5141. That's 800-215-5141.
If you enjoy our Classic Radio Theater broadcasts and want to start building a collection of your own, go to classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. There you'll find links to great classic radio collections on CD, along with links to great reading on classic radio, plus Classic Radio Theater on demand. Check out our webpage, available now at classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. And enjoy. And you're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station. Now the conclusion of the final episode of Rocky Fortune, starring Frank Sinatra, from March 30th, 1954.
Hello?
Shut up.
Anybody in that shed?
Climb into that other can.
Now listen.
I said climb in. One peep and I'll let you have it.
Anything you say.
Now, get down. I'm going to put the cover on.
Now listen.
Do what I say.
Okay, okay. Anybody in here?
Well, hello, officer.
Oh, I thought I heard somebody in here.
Oh, I live here. I just came out to take the garbage cans out front.
Oh, You didn't happen to hear a sound like a couple of shots a minute ago, did you?
Shots? I was rattling these garbage cans so that I couldn't even hear you come down the alley.
Funny. I thought sure they came from behind the house. See, you're a small man to be handling those heavy cans. Here, let me help you roll them out in front.
Oh, that's all right, officer. I can manage them.
Nonsense. I hate to see a man hurt himself. I was out of work for 3 months myself once, lifting a car off a dead body.
Well, you don't say.
Here, I'll wrestle this one for you.
Oh,
my Thompson must do some heavy baking. Well, here goes.
So there I am again, headed for the city dump. I'm afraid to open my app because I don't know whether Gerald has his cannon pointed at me or not, so I figure I'll let him roll me out to the sidewalk before I make my move. By the time I reach the street, I'm so dizzy I feel like I've been somebody's mixer with the dial set at heavy whip.
Oh, thanks, officer. You can just leave them right here. Oh, looks like we missed the morning pickup anyway.
Yeah, there's an empty one here. Well, I'll just be moving along.
Oh, thanks a lot. You're a real lifesaver.
I hate to see a man strain himself. Well, you're in luck. Here comes the garbage truck back from his run. I'll just stop him.
Oh, no. There's no need for that.
Nonsense. He's an old pal of mine. Hey, Hennessy. Hey!
Well, if it ain't New York's finest officer, Clarence Kilcannon.
Hey, Hank, do us a favor, will you? Maude Thompson missed the morning pickup, and she's got a couple of cans loaded to the brim. Would you dump them out?
Thompson, huh? Say, you know, I was emptying one of her cans this morning, and a live character steps out and asks me if this is the subway?
Sure, and you're pulling my leg.
May I never take another breath if it ain't true.
Another drop would be more fitting here now.
Hey, Charlie. Give the officer a hand with those. I wouldn't want him to strain himself.
Up we go.
And off with the lid. Oh, no.
Top of the can to you.
What the... Hey, mister. Hey, come back.
Officer, grab him. There's a corpse in that other can.
Hey, come back. Come back or I'll shoot.
My arm.
Stand still. It's just a scratch. Now, what's this about?
He shot Mrs. Thompson's son. The body's in the other can.
Officer, it's a lie.
Yeah, well, we'll just go back and have a look. Hey, wait a minute.
What is it?
I know you from someplace.
The lineup, maybe?
Lineup? By Godfrey, there's an APB out for this character. Gerald Kent, alias Kinsey, alias Kenoy. He's wanted for the Rensselaer jewels theft with a woman named Norma Lynn.
That's the boy. His wife's inside the house.
Well, we'll just go in and see about that.
Hey, Kev Cannon! What do you want me to do about the garbage?
Stick around, Hennessy. We'll be out in a minute with two cans full. And you can dump them off at the city jail.
NBC has presented Frank Sinatra as that footloose and fancy-free young gentleman, Rocky Fortune. Others in tonight's cast include Frank Richards, Gloria Ann Simpson, Jim Eagles, Virginia Gregg, Eddie Fields, and Maurice Hart. Tonight's script was written by George Lefferts. Andrew C. Love directed. Question. What is the top speed you can safely drive after dark if you have to rely on your own headlights to show up danger? The answer, according to the National Safety Council, is 45 miles per hour. If you exceed 45, you're driving beyond the visibility limit of your headlights. Keep plenty of distance between yourself and the car ahead. The secret of safe driving is simply to use common sense. Take your time, not your life. Tonight, enjoy Fibber, McGee, and Molly on the NBC Radio Network.
And there you have it, March 30th, 1954, Rocky Fortune on Classic Radio Theater, the end of the series. it's Frank Sinatra's success in From Here to Eternity launched him into an entire new realm of acting. When Classic Radio Theater continues in 3 minutes, we'll take you to Pine Ridge, Arkansas, and see what's going on in the environs of the Jotamdown store and Lum N Abner.
It's amazing but true. When it comes to one of America's biggest household expenditures, health care, a lot of people think they've got no choice. People are used to thinking we have to do it this way, but they don't. Yes, you have the freedom to choose an alternative with your health care. It's MediShare, and it costs way less than the alternatives. The typical family saves $500 a month, not a year, a month. And if you're single, this can save you a lot too. And let's face it, a big reason MediShare is 400,000 people strong, it just works. They've shared over $3 billion in medical bills, so they can help share your needs too. Joining MediShare for so many people is one of those things that makes you say, why didn't I do this before? So yes, the time has come for something better. Look into joining MediShare and see why so many people are opting out of the old way and into the new. Why not look into this? Just call 855-90-PSALM. That's 855-90-PSALM. 855-90-PSALM.
Balance of Nature's fruits and veggies in a capsule.
I was singing in the shower, singing El Solo Mio. Oh, Solo Mio. As I was singing Mio, I sneezed. So I'm drying up, you know, and I sneeze again. And I blow my nose. A whole bunch of stuff comes out. I'm suddenly realizing that I am breathing out of my nose the best I've ever breathed out of my nose in years. I don't think it's a coincidence that all of a sudden now I'm breathing. What has happened in the past year? I'm a balanced agent. You know, little by little every day, if I experience it, I'm happy. I'm sure this has to do with the balance of nature. I'm sure it does.
When you call, use discount code USA, and we'll take 20% off any first preferred order of Balance of Nature and have it shipped to you free. Call 1-800-246-8751. That's 1-800-246-8751. Or go online to balanceofnature.com and use discount code USA.
If you enjoy our Classic Radio Theater broadcasts and want to start building a collection of your own, go to classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. There you'll find links to great classic radio collections on CD, along with links to great reading on classic radio, plus Classic Radio Theater on demand. Check out our webpage, available now at classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. And enjoy.
Now you can fly anywhere in the world and pay discount prices on your airline tickets. Book a flight today to London, Paris, Madrid, or anywhere else you want to go. And pay a lot less guaranteed. Call the International Travel Department right now at Low Cost Airlines.
800-215-5141. 800-215-5141. That's 800-215-5141.
Now on Classic Radio Theater, we step back all the way to March 30th, 1938, for an episode of Lum N Abner.
And now let's see what's going on down in Pine Ridge. Well, now that all of Lum N Abner's outside interests have been disposed of, they've decided to devote all of their time to operating their Jotamdown store. During the past few weeks, the store has been neglected to such an extent that the stock has become very depleted and business is steadily falling off. As we look in on the little community today, Pine Ridge is enjoying the first touch of spring weather, and we find Grandpappy Spears over at the store talking with Abner. Listen.
Oh, it just ain't no use to talk about it, Grandpap. I'd love to the worst way, love to, but I just can't get off. Couldn't do it at all.
Well, I just thought I'd mention it to you.
Yeah, sure.
I hadn't thought nothing about it myself till a while ago. Digging around out there in the garden, dug up a whole tomato can full of fish bait.
Well, yeah, it's a pretty day for it, all right.
Well, not only that, but the signs is right, Abner. I was looking at the almanac last night. Couldn't ask the moon to be better for it.
No, no.
Talking to the Macmillan boys, too. They was out yesterday.
They was, huh?
They come by the place along the shank of the evening there, had a string of white pitch, it'd make your mouth water.
Oh, my goodness, only I do love them things, too. I love them.
Oh, yeah. And it's fun catching them, too, when they're biting.
Whereabouts did they go, the Macmillan boys?
Oh, they're down on Big Eddie. they say, in the lower end of the eddy there.
Uh-huh. Well, there's lots of them in that hole of water, all right.
Oh, yeah. And they ought to be biting good today, for they said they throwed a half a sack of cracked corn in there.
They did, huh?
And just about be getting soft enough for them to eat good today.
Oh, my, yes. Lord me, if they'd done that, yeah. Bound you a body couldn't stir them with a stick down
there. Oh,
you
have to get behind a tree to make a hook.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, if I could just get off or get on out of here, Grandpap. Dad, blame it, come over here and get me unsatisfied with myself. I don't know of one thing I'd rather do than to be sitting down there on that riverbank this evening.
Yeah.
Yeah, that big oak, you know, it leans out there with the water, right there at the far end of the hole.
Yeah.
Oh, me. Feller can sit there and lean back again that tree and sun himself. Watch that cork bobbling.
Well, see now, right there by that tree is where they catched all them pierce yesterday, they said.
I knowed it. That, blame it, that's my favorite place, right?
Yes, sir, that's one reason I thought about you. I knowed you always loved to sit out there.
Are you sure that the signs is right, Grandpap?
Oh, they couldn't be better, Abner. Looked it up. Looked it up myself. Ain't you got an almanac around here? I'll show you.
No. I take it up to the place for Elizabeth. She wanted to look up the signs to see when to plant.
Yeah. Well, they're right. I'll guarantee you that.
Uh-huh.
And the dogwood's in bloom. That's sign enough they're biting right there.
Yeah, sure. That blame it. I wish you hadn't come by here, Grandpap.
Well, why don't you ask Lum? He'd let you go in.
No. I daresn't do it, Grandpap. Daresn't do it. He'd throw a fit. Throw a fit right here in the store.
Would I?
Oh, me. I would love to have a mess of them things, too.
Yeah, I'm a-going anyway. I tell you, I could bring you some back, I reckon, Abner. I know I'll catch more than we can eat the way they're biting.
Yeah, well, that's nice, but... Well, that ain't it, though. I'd just love to catch him myself. Doggies, I can see that cork going under now. One of them rascals scooting off with him.
Yeah, all them things fight.
Oh, yes, they do. Yeah.
And there's a few bass hangs around that old tree we stole, man.
Yes, I saw them myself.
Better ought to get a right smart chance of sun pitch along there at the mouth of Shack Creek, there where that clear water empties into the river.
Oh, yeah, bound to be. Bound to be, yes, sir. But, Lum just wouldn't listen to it for a minute.
Well, it won't hurt nothing to ask.
No, ain't no use now. We shaking hands this morning. Said we was going to attend to business from now on. Been fooling around here, digging up these dinosaurs and making moving pictures and one thing and another till... Our business here in the store just went down something wonderful.
Well, can't Lum wait on the trade?
Well, sure. There ain't nothing going on as far as that goes, but, well, it's just the idea of bringing up the subject. I know what he'd say. Claim that I weren't taking the right altitude toward the store here.
Yeah, well, of course, you know what's best. Thought maybe you could tell him you had to go somewhere this afternoon and not tell him where you were going.
No. Now, I wouldn't do nothing like that. If I was going fishing, where could I tell him I was going?
Well, don't know. I hadn't thought nothing about it, hardly.
No. When was you aiming on leaving, Grandpap?
I thought we'd go right away. I got the fishing poles and the tackle all ready over there at the place.
You have, huh?
We could take some victuals along with it. Just cook and eat right there on the bank of the river, sort of.
Oh, I'd love it. I would love it. Yes, sir. I can smell that grub cooking right now. He might cook up some of the fish.
Now, wait a minute. There's Lum coming out there in front there now, Abner.
Huh?
Him and Cedric.
Oh, yeah. I reckon what they're standing out there with their heads together about now.
No telling.
Cedric more likely wanting to borrow some money from him. Well, I can see Lum shaking his head there.
Yeah, well, what are you going to do, Abner? Better make up your mind before he gets in here.
Well, why can I tell him I'm going, Grandpa?
Oh, tell him some of Elizabeth's relays is sick.
Well, ain't none of them lives close enough for me to get to him this afternoon. And he knows I wouldn't care much if there was, no way. No, better just...
Mind out, here he comes.
Dad, blame it all. Why does that fella have to work?
Well, I'll tell you about it, Cedric, and let you know. Where'll you be at? Well, I'll call you and let you know.
Well, howdy,
fella. Hey, come in, Lum. Come in.
Yeah, howdy, Lum. Beautiful day, ain't it? Just like spring outside. Fact is, it is spring. You fellas ought to be sitting out there on the porch getting some of that sunshine.
Oh, me.
Yes, sir. Just walking up out there.
Oh, oh.
No good going.
Oh, me.
What's the matter with you, Abner?
Oh, I don't know. Just got a misery of some kind.
Well, you was all right a while ago.
Yeah.
And it just hit him all of a sudden, Ron.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Something yet, reckon?
Oh.
You ain't been running your hand down that pickle barrel again, have you?
No, no. No, it ain't that. Oh. Maybe I better go home for the rest of the day, Lum.
Well, all right. I sort of aiming on, nothing.
Aiming on what?
Why, nothing. I was just aiming on you staying here while I got out and done a little more collecting this afternoon, but...
Oh, well... I can stay, I reckon. I just thought...
No, no, if you're ailing, wouldn't want you to sit around here trying to drag around, wait on a trade. I can stay here. Do the collecting tomorrow.
No, no, now we're needing to get that money in. No, you go ahead, Lum. I'll stay.
No, it'll wait, it'll wait. I can get out tomorrow and collect.
Well, I think I'll feel better after a little, maybe.
All right. Of course, we are needing some stuff here in the store, and we can't buy till we get out and get some of these collections in.
No, sure, sure, I know. I oughtn't to even thought about it. Well, I'm feeling all right now, I think.
Well, now, Abner, if you're sick, you better go on over to the place and lay down. No telling what it might develop into. Yeah, you do whatever you think best, Abner. I think he just overdone himself last week, Lum, digging so much over there for that dinosaur. Yeah, might have. Does your back hurt you, Abner?
Yeah, I believe right there is where it's at. I never knowed it yet. My back, that's what it's.
Why couldn't you just close the store up, Lum? Ain't nothing going on no way. Well, we could, I guess, for his head goes. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea, Grandpap. Yeah, you go on over home and lay down and rest this afternoon, Abner, and I can get out and do that collecting. We just close up the store for the day.
Well, I hate to be laying up there in bed knowing you're out walking yourself to death trying to collect up some of these debts.
Oh, shut it. Be good for me. Yeah, you go ahead. I'll lock up, Abner.
Well, all right, if you just insist, Lum. Grandpap, I'll get you to walk home with me if you don't mind. Way I'm feeling, I might fall right in the middle of the road before I get there.
Yeah, sure, I'll walk home with you.
Yeah.
Here, give me your arm.
Yeah, thank you. And now, don't worry about me, Lum. You need mice to come over there, call up to find out how I am, but I think I'll be all right quick as I get laid down.
Well, I couldn't hardly get in touch with you this afternoon, Abner, but... See, I'll be out collecting, but I'll call you quick as I get back tonight.
Well, good. All right, Lum. It's so long.
Yeah, I hope you get to feeling better.
Well, I think I will.
Huh. Granny, he oughtn't to be walking that fast. Shape he's in. hello? Cedric? Well, I oughtn't to, but I've decided to go with you. Yeah, Abner went home sick, and I'm just going to have to close up the store. Yeah, I feel kind of bad about it, him homesick, but I'm going anyway. Yeah, you get the fishing tackle and the bait, and I'll meet you there at the corner of Ezra Seastrunk's place. Why, I believe we better chance it down on Big Eddie, Cedric. Yeah, down there where that big oak tree leans out over the river. That's my favorite spot. Grannies, if they ain't biting there today, we couldn't catch them no place. All right, Cedric, see you directly. Goodbye.
And we imagine there'll be quite a surprise meeting down the river this afternoon.
Might say it's a meeting of the Jot'em Down Store Board of Directors. March 30th, 1938, Lum and Abner on Classic Radio Theater.
Hey, we got big news today for all anchovy lovers.
Anchovies, as you know, friends, are small little fish of the herring family, noted for their peculiar flavor, and used for pickling and as a sauce or a canopy.
Anchovies come curled up like little snails, and there was a time when this was considered fashionable and decorative, but... Not anymore.
No, no longer should anchovies be served all rolled up in a little ball, friends. Today, anchovies should be served long.
Anchovy strips, we call them. And if you haven't had anchovy strip salad or an anchovy wedge, you haven't really enjoyed anchovies as they should be enjoyed.
You bring in camera one, please. You'll see here on the table, friends, a small ironing board together with the new Bob and Ray anchovy ironer.
Now, you can iron your own anchovies right at home there with very little trouble and at practically no expense.
I'm going to iron a few anchovies right here in the studio so that you can see for yourself how easy it really is.
Well, if you can iron a shirt, you'll have no trouble ironing an anchovy. No buttons to iron around, no pleats to beware of, and nothing to starch.
First, you gently test the iron by wetting your finger and... Ow, touching it to the bottom of the iron like I did there.
That's a little too hot, isn't it?
Yeah.
Then, taking the anchovy...
Oh, see, it's set for wool.
Oh, yeah. Try it on...
Set, I'll have to set it for fish. Wait a minute.
I'll try it.
That's better.
That's better. Now, take the anchovy between your thumb and second finger, place it on the table, put the point of the iron at the base of the anchovy.
Now, you gently press the anchovy out, prodding with the point of the iron until flat, like I'm doing here.
That's all there is to it. Lift up the iron, take a sharp knife, and pry the anchovy from the base of the iron onto a plate.
Now, to get this bargain of a lifetime, write to Pressed Flat, New York.
Well, there you have it. We go from Lum and Abner to Bob and Ray on Classic Radio Theater. We hope you will take a moment to find us on at our website, which is classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream, where you can stream Classic Radio Theater podcasts, learn more about Classic Radio Theater collecting, and contact me there. And you can also find out some of the things that I do when I'm away from this microphone. ClassicRadio.stream. You can also email me, ClassicRadioTheater@gmail.com. And our podcasts are available anywhere fine podcasts are served. iTunes, Spreaker, the iHeartRadio app. Just search for USA Classic Radio Theater. I'm Wyatt Cox. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Thank this radio station, support the advertisers, and as always, tell a friend that the great radio shows are back. Classic Radio Theater right here on your favorite radio station and the USA Radio Network.
The USA Radio Network presents the greatest radio programs of all time.
Suspense. Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to hear is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Dragnet.
This is Classic Radio Theater.
Gangbusters!
I was a communist for the FBI.
Lights out, everybody.
Now here's your host, Wyatt Cox.
Jack Webb stars in an episode of Dragnet, The Big Confession. This originally broadcast on March 30th, 1954.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to hear is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Dragnet.
You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned to homicide detail. A young man walks into your office and tells you he has a problem. From the way he talks, you know it's serious. Your job? Listen.
The documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case transcribed from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Wednesday, September 8th. It was cold in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of homicide detail. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Captain Lum N. My name's Friday. I was on my way back to the office from R&I, and it was 10:14 a.m. when I got to room 42. Homicide.
Pardon me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you a policeman?
Yes, sir, that's right. What can I do for you?
I want to talk to somebody. I'm not sure who, though.
Well, if you tell me what it's all about, I might be able to help you.
Well, I got to be sure it's the right person. You can understand that, can't you?
Yes, sir.
My name's Paul Marcus.
All right, Mr. Marcus, what is it you want to talk about?
Do you work in there in the homicide department?
That's right.
You know all about murders, then, huh?
You want to come into the office and talk?
No, I don't want to go in there. Is there someplace else we can go? I'd like to talk to you alone. This is kind of a personal thing.
All right, sir. Come on down the hall. Interrogation room.
Nobody else there?
No.
Well, that's good, because like I told you, this is a personal matter. I need your advice.
All right, sir, this way.
This is the first time I've ever been in the police department. I feel kind of funny just walking in and talking personal things to a stranger.
Yes, sir, I can understand. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Want to sit down right there?
Thank you.
All right, you want to tell me about it?
You mind closing the door?
All right. Right now, what's your problem, Mr. Marcus?
I told you it was personal.
Yes, I know.
I want to be sure I handle it right. I could get in a lot of trouble if I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Been trying to figure out what to do about it for a week now and couldn't find the right answer. That's why I came here. You guys should know.
All right, now if you'll just tell me what's bothering you, we might be able to do something for you.
Uh-huh. A whole week and no answer. I sure hope you've got it for me.
I'm sorry, Mr. Marcus, but if you don't tell me what this is all about, there's nothing we can do.
Well, it's nothing big, just a personal problem. I just want to know how to handle it.
All right, go ahead.
I killed a woman.
10:18 a.m. We got the name of the woman Paul Marcus said that he'd murdered. We also obtained a description of the victim, and Frank went down the hall to missing persons to see if a report had been filed on her. I waited with the suspect.
It's a personal problem. You know how to handle it, and I wasn't sure. That's why I came to you.
All right, where did you meet this Lorraine Farrell?
San Francisco.
How long ago?
A couple of weeks. I just knew her a little while before it happened, just a couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Fisherman's Wharf.
What's that?
Fisherman's Wharf. That's where I met her in San Francisco. I was on a vacation. 2 weeks with pay, and I went to San Francisco. Fisherman's Wharf. That's where I met Lorraine.
All right, go ahead.
Well, I was down there sitting on the dock looking at the boats, just sitting there eating prawns. You know how they cook them in those great big pots?
Yeah.
Well, I was just sitting there eating prawns, and I met her.
Well, where'd you kill her?
Look, you've got to let me tell this in my own way, or I'm not going to tell you at all. It's got to be right so you'll understand. Now, if you don't get it right, the whole thing's gone wrong. You see, it's a real personal thing.
All right, sir, go ahead.
Well, I was just sitting there eating prawns, eating them, and throwing the little tail pieces down in the water. You know how you do.
Mm-hmm.
Watching them kind of float around. Kind of all of a sudden, she was right there sitting just alongside of me.
You ever see her before?
I never laid eyes on her till then.
All right, go ahead.
Well, we both sat there for a minute, and then we started to talk. Just little things like nice weather and how long you've been in San Francisco, things like that. You know how you do.
How old did you say the Farrell woman was?
19. Turned 19 the 5th of August.
All right.
She was born there, you know, in San Francisco. She told me about it when we were talking, how she was born there and grew up there.
Yeah.
Told me all about the school she went to, how she used to play on Strawberry Island and Stowe Lake. You ever been there?
Yes, sir.
It's kind of a beautiful place, you know. They got those rowboats and you paddle around the lake, and right in the middle is this island, Strawberry Island. There's all those swans that swim around. You can feed them. Real beautiful Strawberry Island.
Tell me something, Marcus. You ever been in the hospital?
Huh?
You ever had any mental care? Been under the supervision of a psychiatrist, maybe?
You think I'm crazy, don't you?
No, I just ask you a question.
Well, I'm not. I've never been to a doctor. I'm telling you the truth. You'll see.
All right, you want to go ahead?
I guess you get a lot of crackpots in here telling you all kinds of phony stories, huh?
The doors are wide open all night.
I guess you get a lot of them. But I'm not a crackpot. I'm telling you the truth. I did kill her. But it's important you know why I did it. I got to tell you the right way. If I don't, none of it's going to be any good.
When'd you kill her?
September 1st, that's the day we left. September 1st.
That'd be a week ago today, huh?
Yeah, September 1st.
Joe?
Yeah.
See you in a minute.
All right, just a minute, Marcus.
Mm-hmm.
All right, what do you got?
Well, I checked missing persons.
Yeah.
I got a report on the girl, same name, description matches.
When'd she disappear?
September 1st.
Well, that fits in with what he told us.
Yeah, but there's something that doesn't.
What's that?
She's 16 years old.
Each year, there are hundreds of citizens who walk into the nearest police station and confess to some sort of crime. Some have actually happened, others have occurred only in the mind of the person confessing. No matter how wild the confession, how implausible the details of the crime, each report has to be checked out. To doctors, such cases are clinical, but to the working detective, they're the cause of a lot of legwork and a great deal of checking. They cost the taxpayer untold man-hours in investigating time and many times result in nothing. Because of his attitude and his reluctance to give us the complete story all at once, it appeared that Paul Marcus might be one of these people. The fact that he named a girl who was missing meant little, since it was possible for him to have read the story in a newspaper. The only way we had of being sure was to continue the interrogation. 10:34 a.m.
She told me she wanted to get away from home. That's what she told me, how it was rough for her there, and she wanted to get away.
Mm-hmm. That's when you said you'd bring her down here, is that right?
Oh, no, I didn't even suggest it. The whole thing was her idea.
She brought it up?
Yes. You see, after that first day on Fisherman's Wharf, I saw her several times. Almost every day, we'd meet someplace and talk.
Where would you meet her?
Well, sometimes in one of the hotel bars. Once we met out at the Steinhardt Aquarium. We met on the rotunda there. You know where they have the big pool and all the alligators swimming around? You know where?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we met there once, and we walked over to the place where they have the band concerts, right across the way where the band plays, only they weren't there that day. Wasn't anybody there, just Lorraine and me. We sat on the benches and talked. That's when she said she wanted to go with me.
To Los Angeles, huh?
Yeah. That's where I was going, and she wanted me to take her.
She came right out and asked you?
Sure. Told me how it was hard for her at home, and she wanted to get away. She told me she had friends here. Said she could stay with them until she got things straightened out. You know, get a job and a place of her own.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she was going to do that, get a place of her own and a job, and then she'd be all right.
You ever meet her parents?
No, I never went to the house. She told me where it was, though, someplace out by the Twin Peaks Tunnel. I didn't know where exactly. She didn't want me to go out there. Said it would only cause her more trouble. That's why I'd meet her in town.
You ever meet any of her friends up in San Francisco?
Yeah, just once we were in a drugstore on Market Street having a sandwich. We were just sitting there, and she was telling me how it was bad for her at home, and a girl came in. Looked like she was a schoolgirl. You know how I mean, young?
Mm-hmm.
Well, she came in and talked to Lorraine, then they went over to the phone booths and talked.
You didn't actually meet the girl?
No. No, Lorraine said if I did, the girl might say something to Lorraine's parents, and that would cause trouble.
You know this girl's name?
I think it was Grace. I'm not sure, but I think it was Grace.
When'd you leave San Francisco?
Wednesday morning, September 1st. I want to get back in time to get some rest before I had to go to work. You know, my vacation was up, and I had to go back to work.
Where'd you pick up the girl?
Wasn't a pickup. I was sitting on Fisherman's Wharf, eating prawns and looking at the boats, and we started to talk. Wasn't a pickup. We just got friendly.
No, Marcus, he means that where'd you pick up the girl when you left for Los Angeles?
Oh, I thought you meant when I met her the first time. That's what I thought.
Uh-huh.
I met her out at the tunnel.
Where's that?
Well, you know where Castro Street runs into Market, where the L car comes in from the beach? That's where I met her. She came from home, had her suitcase and all, and she came out on the L car.
All right, go ahead.
Well, she got off the streetcar, got into my car, and we left for Los Angeles.
Where'd you kill her?
I told you before, if I don't tell it my way, it isn't going to work. You're not going to understand. It's got to be my way.
All right, go ahead, Mark.
Well, it was a beautiful day, just the kind of a day you want when you're going on a drive. You know how I mean, clear and the sun shining.
Yeah.
Well, that's what kind of a day it was.
Uh-huh.
You could see all across the bay, over to Berkeley and way up north. It was real clear.
You want to go ahead with your story?
Mr. Friday?
Mm-hmm.
My way?
Yes, all right, go ahead.
All right. We drove all day, stopped for lunch at a place near San Luis Obispo, a little lunch stand there. Had a French dip sandwich that was one of the best I ever had. The meat was real lean, and they didn't sop up the bun with the gravy. Just the right amount. One of the best I ever ate.
Mm-hmm.
Lorraine liked them, too. She didn't like the bread all sopped up with gravy.
Well, go ahead. What happened after you had lunch?
Well, we left there and drove on. We got down to around Malibu. I guess it was really before that, where the divided highway is, up the coast. You know where the cliffs are?
Yeah, we know.
Well, we stopped. She was such a beautiful night, I just wanted to sit there and look at the ocean. People don't take time anymore.
What happened then?
We just sat there, had a cigarette, and talked. That's when I told her. First time I ever said it.
What was that?
It's funny. I guess most fellas say it a lot. You know how I mean to a bunch of girls and never mean it?
Go ahead.
I told her. First time I said I loved her, and I told her that she didn't have to get a job, that I wanted to marry her, get her a house and all, and she wouldn't have no more trouble at home. How she'd have her own home, and everything would be all right. I told her all that.
Yeah.
And that's when I knew, right then. You could divide the second in a million parts, and in one of them, one of the parts, I knew I had to do it.
Kill her?
Yeah. You see, she didn't tell me the real reason. She lied to me, and I knew I had to do it. So she wouldn't lie to anyone else. You can understand that. You can see why I had to do it.
Well, maybe you better tell us.
Well, it was all a lie, all about the family being mean to her. All that was a lie. She just wanted to get to Los Angeles because she wanted to meet some other fella here. That's why. She lied about the family, and that's why she did it. So you see, I had to kill her. I had to.
How'd you kill her?
Huh?
I say, how did you kill her?
We got out of the car and walked over to the cliffs. We could see right down to the ocean. We just stood there. I just hit her. She fell down. It was quiet. So I pushed her over into the water.
Mm-hmm. What'd you do then, Marcus?
I got in the car and drove home.
You just left her there, huh?
Certainly. There wasn't anything I could do for her.
You point out the place where all this happened?
Well, sure. It's up the coast where the highway's divided, north of Malibu. It's real easy to find.
Anybody else around?
You mean when I hit her?
That's right.
No, we were all alone. I didn't see anybody, just the two of us.
All right, Marcus, you willing to give us a statement on all this?
You mean what I just told you?
Yeah.
Well, sure. You want me to tell all about it again?
We'll call in a stenographer.
So you can write it down, huh?
That's the idea.
Well, sure, I'll tell her.
Tell me something, Marcus. When'd you get out of the hospital?
I told you before, I was never in one. You guys sure make it tough, don't you?
What's that?
I came in here because I wanted to tell you about Lorraine. I wanted you to know so you wouldn't think it was my fault, that's all. So you wouldn't think it was my fault, and now you don't believe me. You think I'm just another crackpot trying to sell a phony story. You guys sure make it tough.
We gotta be sure.
Well, I'm telling you the truth. I want you to believe me.
Yeah.
I want you to believe me.
And we're beginning to. A statement was taken from the suspect, and he was booked in at the main jail on a charge of suspicion of violation of Section 187 PC, murder. We sent a teletype to San Francisco, and we contacted Inspectors Ed Vandervoort and John O'Hare of Homicide Detail. We filled them in and asked that they check out the suspect's story on their end. We also asked that they send us all available information on the missing girl and that they check with her family and try to get a list of any known associates that she might have had in the Los Angeles area. Frank and I checked out of the office at 7:48 p.m. and we went home for the night. The following morning at 9:23 a.m., Inspector Vandervoort from San Francisco called back.
Uh-huh. Yeah. When was that, Ed? Wait a minute. All right, yeah, I got it. How about friends down here? I say, how about friends down here? Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. Well, it should be here this afternoon, then. Right. Yeah, we'll check them out. No, that's on the way. We put it in the mail for you last night. Well, you should have it by now, then. Okay, right. Right, Ed, thanks very much. We'll be checking with you. Right. Bye.
How about it?
Well, they checked the family and the friends, the place where Marcus said he stayed up there.
Yeah.
Marcus' story checks out all the way.
You are listening to Dragnet, the authentic story of your police force in action.
March 30th, 1954, Dragnet on Classic Radio Theater.
This is a national health alert from the Healthcare Hotline. Are you on Medicare and/or have private insurance and suffer from back pain? MD Topical has a solution for you. Today, you can qualify to receive a pain-relieving treatment, such as a comfortable back brace or a customized pain treatment, at little or no cost. Call MD Topical toll-free now, 877-875-5909. It just takes a couple of minutes to qualify for these amazing treatments that have helped thousands of people with severe pain. Your personalized pain treatment will be delivered directly to your door. Call MD Topical toll-free, 877-875-5909, or go to mdtopical.com and get started on your road to a pain-free life. Call MD Topical toll-free, 877-875-5909, or go to mdtopical.com.
Mike Lindell, the creator of MyPillow, is a sleep genius. He creates things to make your night's sleep better. He created the new Giza Dreams bed sheets. He started by using the world's best cotton grown in the Mediterranean, and it's ultra soft, breathable, and extremely durable. Now, if you go to MyPillow.com, use promo code USA when you click on the Giza Dreams sheet special, you get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off and free shipping when you go to MyPillow.com.
Now you can fly anywhere in the world and pay discount prices on your airline tickets. Book a flight today to London, Paris, Madrid, or anywhere else you want to go. And pay a lot less guaranteed. Call the International Travel Department right now at Low Cost Airlines.
800-215-5141. 800-215-5141. That's 800-215-5141.
Were you scammed into signing a timeshare contract? And did you miss the part that said you have to pay for your great idea? Not only for the rest of your life, but when you're not here anymore, you get to pass this turkey onto your family for them to pay for the rest of their lives. Thanks, Dad. Don't burden your family down the road, and don't be stuck with expensive timeshare payments forever. Get out of your bad idea timeshare contract guaranteed or pay nothing. Call Resort Release today and learn for free how their timeshare exit team can help you legally exit your timeshare contract. They've helped thousands of people, and they're A-plus rated with a BBB. So if you feel scammed, get mad, and get out of your expensive timeshare contract right now, guaranteed. Call NOW.
800-586-7112. 800-586-7112. 800-586-7112. That's 800-586-7112.
You're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station, March 30th, 1954, Dragnet, The Big Confession.
One of the biggest comedy hits of the year. That's how the movie critics are describing Bob Hope's latest Paramount picture, Casanova's Big Night. Like so many other millions of smokers, Bob and Audrey Dalton, who appears with him in the picture, say, Chesterfield's for me. First, Audrey Dalton.
I changed to Chesterfield King Size because I think it's better than any other king size cigarette.
Bob Hope says,
5 years, that's how long I've been smoking Chesterfields. And they have what it takes to satisfy me. What's more, I've seen how they make Chesterfields down in their Durham factory. And I wouldn't smoke any other cigarette. Try Chesterfields yourself. You'll find they're best for you, too.
Yes, either way, regular or king size, smoke America's most popular two-way cigarette. Join the thousands now changing to Chesterfield.
In the phone conversation, we learned that all of Lorraine Farrell's friends and relatives had been interviewed and their stories checked with the one given us by the suspect, Marcus. The girl and Paul Marcus had been seen together in the Bay City. The desk clerk at the hotel where the suspect had stayed verified the date that he'd checked out. It was the same day Lorraine Farrell disappeared. The officers in San Francisco were able to contact the girl the suspect had referred to as Grace. She recalled seeing a man answering Marcus' description with a missing Farrell girl. Frank and I spent the rest of the day checking on the suspect. We talked to the people he worked with. They described Marcus as being moody and withdrawn. We talked with his landlady. Her description of the suspect's attitude was the same that we'd gotten before. We thoroughly searched Marcus's apartment, and in a desk drawer, we found a loose-leaf notebook with several pages of penciled notes describing the trip that he'd taken up to San Francisco. On one of the pages, at the back of the book, we found a lengthy letter to a Lorraine, in which Marcus apologized to the girl for killing her, but he went on to explain that he had no choice. We booked this evidence. The following morning, Friday, September 10th, Frank and I drove down to the beach, and we talked to the people in the vicinity where the suspect said the murder had occurred. We found an elderly couple who lived in a trailer on the beach. They recalled having seen two people answering the description of the suspect and the missing girl on the night that the murder occurred. We drove back to the main jail and we signed out Marcus. We took him down to the car and we drove him out to the beach. We turned up the highway and told him to let us know when we came to the place where he killed the Farrell girl.
Sure you know where the place is, Marcus?
Yeah, I remember. It's just up the road a little bit. Just keep right on going. You'll find it.
Mm-hmm. You'll see it now. There's kind of a parking place and a couple of trees. Eucalyptus, I think. There's two of them on the side of the parking place. You can't miss them. It's right ahead there on the left. There, you see?
Yeah. I'm gonna pull in, Frank.
Okay. Just look at all those cars. Everybody's in such a hurry, they never see anything, just like they had blinders on.
You sure this is the place?
I told you, didn't I? No reason to say a thing like that if it wasn't true. Just pull right in there. That's it, right over there. Well, right here is where I parked when it happened. Maybe over there a little bit more, but... oh, right about here.
And the two of you just sat here for a few minutes, is that it?
Yeah. We just sat here and had a cigarette, then we got out of the car and walked over to the edge of the cliff.
All right, come on. Show us.
Sure. So you'll believe me, I'll show you. Now, we stood right over there. Right there, and I told her I was in love with her and wanted to marry her.
Now, you stay here. Just point out where you were.
You think I might try to jump off, don't you? That's what you think, isn't it?
You just show us, huh?
Wouldn't do that. There's no reason to. I don't know why you wouldn't agree that I had to do it. I didn't have any other way to do it.
Where were you when you hit her?
Right there, near that clump of grass. We stood there and looked down at the ocean, and she told me about this other guy. That's when I hit her. She fell down right about there.
Uh-huh. And where'd you push her off the cliff?
There, right where I hit her. She was just lying there. I guess she hit her head on something, and she was real quiet. I just rolled her over the edge. It was right there. There, you see where the rocks are kind of worn?
Go and take a look.
Yeah.
No, you wait here.
Gee, if I'd have known it was going to be this hard to get it straightened out, I don't think I'd have started the thing. When am I going to get out of jail?
That isn't up to us.
Well, then I want to talk to the people who it's up to. I got to tell them about Lorraine, how she lied to me and why I had to kill her. As soon as they hear the story, they'll understand. They got to realize that there wasn't any other way.
How's it look?
Well, I found this caught in a branch just over the edge.
No.
It's a girl's handkerchief. Read the name on it.
Yeah. Lorraine.
Friday, September 10th, 3:46 p.m. We contacted the crime lab and asked them to come out and go over the scene. Officers stood by so that any physical evidence would not be disturbed until Lieutenant Lee Jones and his men had an opportunity to go over it. Frank and I, along with the suspect, drove back to town where we made arrangements with the city lifeguard service to search for the body. The following morning, a boat equipped with diving gear left Santa Monica Harbor and took a course north. experienced deep-sea divers searched the crevices in the rocks beneath the cliffs. All of the sea bordering the vicinity was gone over. There was no trace of a body. The shoreline on either side of the murder spot was checked. Still no trace of the missing girl. In the meantime, two additional teams of men were assigned to check out the friends of Lorraine Farrell. They carried pictures of Paul Marcus and attempted to dig out any information on the suspect and the missing girl. 6:42 p.m., Sunday. We called the main jail and asked that the suspect be brought to the city hall for additional questioning.
I had a reason to do what I did, a good reason. Now, you let me talk to the responsible people around here, and I'll have them tell you. I'm getting a little tired of being shoved around. You just bring in the boss and let me talk to him.
What day did you say that you left San Francisco?
September 1st.
I thought it was the 2nd.
The 1st.
You said you left in the afternoon, is that right?
In the morning, and you'll remember it. I don't know what all these questions are for. I told you I killed Lorraine. I walked in here and told you there's no reason for all this McGill. Just no reason.
Where'd you hide the body?
I didn't hide it.
Well, and where is it?
I told you, I put her in the ocean.
We haven't been able to find her.
Well, then you're not looking good. I told you the truth all along the line. I've told you.
You sure you didn't make a mistake about where all this happened?
Not a chance in the world. Right there by the parking place where the two trees are.
Well, maybe you just thought you left her there.
I know it.
Had you been drinking when you killed her?
No. We'd stopped and had a couple of beers on the way. Just a couple, not enough to get drunk.
But you did have something to drink.
Well, sure, but not enough to get drunk on.
How many beers you had?
Two, maybe three.
All right, which was it? Two or three?
Well, what difference does it make?
Were you drunk?
No.
How about the girl? Was she drunk?
No.
You sure about that?
Yes, yes, I'm sure. What are you trying to do? What difference does it make? Maybe we did have more than a couple, but what difference does it make?
I'm just trying to get things straight.
We want to be sure we got the right story.
Well, you have.
Ah, but have they? March 30th, 1954, Dragnet. The conclusion in 4 minutes on Classic Radio Theater.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrin for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Aronson. I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
Oh my gosh, you've heard me talking about MyPillow and how it helps you get a great night's sleep. Well, Mike Lindell, the sleep savant, has come up with something even better to help you get a great night's sleep. He created these new Giza Dreams bed sheets. Now, he started by using the world's best cotton called Giza. It's only grown in a region between the Sahara, the Mediterranean, and the Nile. Now, it's ultra soft, breathable, and durable. That's one of the most important things. I mean, it's comfortable and it doesn't last, what sense does it make? But it's really durable. Now, the Giza Dream Sleep Set also includes two full 21-inch wide pillowcases that will fit over any MyPillow and deep pocket sheets that will fit over any mattress. Now, the first night you sleep on these sheets, you'll never want to sleep on anything else. Got these on my bed right now. When I crawl into bed, it feels like I'm sleeping at a five-star motel. Now, if you go right now to MyPillow.com, click on the Giza Dream Sheets Special, and use promo code USA, you're going to get 30% off and free shipping. 30% off, free shipping. But enter promo code USA when you go to MyPillow.com. And by the way, that promo code works on just about anything on the MyPillow.com website. So check it out. But the Giza Dream Sleep Set, you will love these. Click on the special. Use promo code USA to get 30% off at MyPillow.com.
Now you can fly anywhere in the world and pay discount prices on your airline tickets. Book a flight today to London, Paris, Madrid, or anywhere else you want to go. And pay a lot less guaranteed. Call the International Travel Department right now at Low Cost Airlines.
800-215-5141. 800-215-5141. That's 800-215-5141.
If you enjoy our classic radio theater broadcasts and want to start building a collection of your own, go to classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. There you'll find links to great classic radio collections on CD, along with links to great reading on classic radio, plus classic radio theater on demand. Check out our webpage, available now at classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. And enjoy. And you're listening to Classic Radio Theater on your favorite station. Now the conclusion of Dragnet, The Big Confession, from March 30th, 1954.
Really? How about a cigarette, huh?
Yeah, thanks.
Frank?
Yeah, thanks. Here, I got a match.
Hey, wait a minute. Don't light his, too. That's bad.
What do you mean?
Three on a match. It's bad.
It is, huh?
Well, sure, you never do that. Here.
Thanks.
You got right home after you killed the Farrell girl, huh?
Yeah. I drove right down the highway and went home. Traffic was kind of heavy. I thought about it, all those people all hurrying around, not taking any time.
Anybody see you when you came home?
What do you mean?
Well, anybody see you park the car, go into your apartment?
Well, no, there wasn't anybody around.
Now, you said when you met the girl up in San Francisco that she had a suitcase with her, is that right?
Yeah, she did. Artificial leather with real leather binding.
And where is it now?
Huh?
What'd you do with her suitcase?
Well, I don't know. I don't remember it.
We couldn't find it in your room.
Well, you didn't have no right to go through my room. No right at all.
We didn't find the suitcase. Where is it?
Well, I don't know.
Did you put it with a body?
Well, I might have.
Where?
I don't know. I don't remember. I hit her. She lied to me, and I hit her. And I pushed her into the ocean. That's all I know. And that's all I'm going to tell you.
Joan, see you a minute.
Yeah, sure. What do you got, Al?
We found the girl.
Where?
She's sitting in a squad room.
Frank stayed with the suspect in the interrogation room, and I went with Sergeant Al Olivas up to the office. Sitting at one of the tables was a small girl with jet black hair. As we came into the room, she was putting on lipstick. She glanced over at us, and then she went back to what she was doing. There wasn't any doubt about it. The girl in the squad room was Lorraine Farrell. She dyed her hair, and she had on a lot of makeup, but it was the missing girl.
Joe, this is Miss Farrell, Joe Friday.
How do you do?
Hi.
Where'd you find her, Al?
Friend up in Eagle Rock. Says she's been there for a week.
Mm. Thanks, Al.
Right.
You seen the papers lately, Miss Farrell?
Yeah, I read the funnies.
You ought to read the front page. You've been on them.
All right.
Mm-hmm. We've got a lot of policemen out looking for you.
They probably needed the exercise anyway.
There's a man down the hall who thinks that he killed you.
That creep, Paul?
Yeah, Paul Marcus, that's his name.
Real creep. I was glad to get away from him. Oh, gosh, he tried to give me about our home. What a baloney. He's a real creep. You ought to keep an eye on him. He's going to wig one of these days.
Is that so?
Yeah. He drove me down here, and when I told him I didn't want to have anything to do with him, he got real sore, started yelling. Creep.
Where'd all this happen, miss?
Out by Malibu. Road out there. Stopped the car and gave me all the stuff about wanting to marry me. I was in love with me. Big deal. Said I was the first girl I ever said that to. Big deal.
What happened then?
I told him I didn't want no part of him. Told him to get lost. Thanked him for the ride and told him to get lost. He flipped. Bad, he flipped. I took off, got a ride, came into the town. I got this girlfriend, Eagle Rock. I've been out there. You ought to watch that guy, though.
Mm-hmm. How old did you tell him that you were?
I don't know. Forget. I think 19, something like that. I forget.
Mm-hmm.
He confessed to killing me, huh?
That's right.
Flipped. He's a wig.
Let's take a walk, huh?
Where?
Come on.
Sure. I've got nothing to lose. Can you guys drive me back to Eagle Rock tonight? I got a date. I got to be back pretty quick.
You're not going to go back to Eagle Rock.
Who says so?
We're going to have to hold you.
Well, what? I haven't done anything.
Well, you're a minor. We've got a missing report filed on you. Your folks are pretty worried.
They're always worrying about something. There ain't nothing for them to worry about, then they worry about that.
Well, it doesn't make any difference. We're going to have to hold you.
You just try it, cop. You just try it. You'll find out you got more trouble than you came in one lump.
Uh-huh. In here. This is Lorraine Farrell, Officer Smith.
Hello.
Lorraine.
Hi, creep.
I didn't mean to do it. You know that. I didn't really mean to do it, but there wasn't any other way.
What's plan? You know what he's talking about?
He thinks he killed you.
Wait.
I didn't think I'd ever see you again. I didn't think I would. But I want you to know one thing, Lorraine.
What's that?
I forgive you for lying.
I told you it happened.
Yeah, come on.
Where to?
We'll take you to the office and call a policewoman.
Then to the can, huh?
The juvenile hall. Come on, let's go.
I'll take her, Joe.
Right.
Bye, Paul.
Bye, Lorraine. I'm not mad at you anymore.
You know, I was worried.
Sergeant?
Yeah.
I want you to know how I appreciate it.
Yeah, what's that?
What you tried to do, I think it was real fine, thanks.
I don't know what you mean.
You didn't fool me a bit.
What?
I know I killed her.
The story you've just heard is true. The names were changed to protect the innocent.
On October 4th, the hearing was held in Department 98, Superior Court, State of California, in and for the County of Los Angeles. Paul Nelson Marcus was held to answer a charge of violation of Section 701 WIC, contributing to the delinquency of a minor. After due deliberation, he was placed on probation and delivered into the hands of a competent psychiatrist. Lorraine Jean Farrell was returned to the custody of her parents. You have just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department. Technical advisors Captain Jack Donahoe, Sergeant Marty Wynn, Sergeant Vance Brasher. Heard tonight were Ben Alexander, Herb Ellis. Script by John Robinson. Music by Walter Schumann. Hal Gibney speaking.
Watch an entirely different Dragnet case history each week on your local NBC television station. Please check your newspapers for the day and time.
March 30th, 1954, Dragnet on Classic Radio Theater coming up in 3 minutes. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Do you wish you could get better sleep and maybe lose a few pounds? Maybe more than a few pounds? Well, there's this product called Calitrin that helps with both sleep and weight loss. Just listen to what people are saying about it.
I've been taking Calitrim for right about 3 months, and I've lost 24 pounds and 19 overall inches. But my sleep has improved, I have so much more energy, and I have the desire to succeed more than ever. Anyone who needs weight loss, more energy, and better sleep, this product really does deliver.
Hi, I'm Roger. Over the 3 months that I took the product, my sleeping habits are increasingly much better. I got a better night's sleep, and I just can't say enough about the product and how it makes you feel. Also, additionally lost a little bit of weight on the program as well.
Hi, this is Ayres, and I take Calitrin for weight loss, and I've lost about 20 pounds, and I feel great.
Calitrin is scientifically proven to help with sleep and weight loss safely and effectively. Check it out at toploss.com. That's toploss.com.
It's amazing but true, when it comes to one of America's biggest household expenditures, healthcare, a lot of people think they've got no choice. People are used to thinking we have to do it this way, but they don't. Yes, you have the freedom to choose an alternative with your healthcare. It's MediShare, and it costs way less than the alternatives. The typical family saves $500 a month, not a year. A month. And if you're single, this can save you a lot too. And let's face it, a big reason MediShare is 400,000 people strong, it just works. They've shared over $3 billion in medical bills, so they can help share your needs too. Joining MediShare for so many people is one of those things that makes you say, why didn't I do this before? So yes, the time has come for something better. Look into joining MediShare and see why so many people are opting out of the old way and into the new. Why not look into this? Just call 855-90-PSALM. That's 855-90-PSALM. 855-90-PSALM.
Tired of overpaying for the little blue pill? What if you could get the exact same results for just a fraction of the price, guaranteed? Well, now you can with Sildenafil, the active ingredient in the blue pill. With 20 milligram generic Sildenafil tablets, you get the exact same results for less than $2 per pill. And again, the results are guaranteed. That's right, absolutely guaranteed results for a fraction of the cost of the little blue pill. So give your wallet a break and call us toll-free at 800-362-6091 to get your generic Sildenafil delivered discreetly to your door. And of course, while saving hundreds of dollars, you'll also be saving time by saying goodbye to those long, embarrassing pharmacy lines once and for all. Again, just call 800-362-6091 and get your generic Sildenafil with a 100% money-back guarantee. Getting your pills doesn't get any easier or cheaper than this, so call 800-362-6091 now.
Now on Classic Radio Theater, the final part of the five-part Yours Truly Johnny Dollar story, The Lamarr Matter, as it was originally broadcast on March 30th, 1956.
From Hollywood, it's time now for...
Johnny Dollar.
This is Larry Comstock, Johnny, at Tri-Mutual Insurance. You're out at the Lamarr home.
Yeah, Larry.
Police crime lab, find out anything more about the stuff from here they took in for examination?
Yes. Yes, they certainly did.
Well?
They found traces of that poison, pyrodameron, on the toothbrush that Thomas Lamarr was using just before he
on
died.
The Are you kidding?
Oh, no. No, indeed, John. Not a bit.
There's a murder weapon for you. A toothbrush. Larry, send the cops out here. I think I've just about got this case sewed up.
Tonight and every weekday night, Bob Bailey in the transcribed adventures of the man with the action-packed expense account, America's fabulous freelance insurance investigator.
Yours truly, Johnny Dollar. Expense account submitted by Special Investigator Johnny Dollar, location South Bend, Indiana. To the Universal Adjustment Bureau, Hartford, Connecticut. The following is my final entry of expenses incurred during investigation of the Lamarr murder. And murder it most certainly was. It was in La Jolla, California, during my so-called vacation, that I met, and I must admit, kind of fell for Vonnie Lamarr. It was from La Jolla that I flew her back to South Bend, Indiana, when we both received news of her foster father's sudden death. All the clues I'd been able to dig up seemed to point to one Walter Marson, who had been Lamar's personal secretary and who lived at the Lamarr mansion. At his room there in the house, I found the one book in the world that described the poison, pyrodameron, that had killed Thomas René Lamarr. Poison derived from a pretty little yellow flower once raised on an island near Greece. A flower with sudden death in its pollen. Huh?
You're Johnny Dollar, aren't you? Harrison the butler said you were up here.
And you must be Walter Marson.
What are you doing in my room?
Let me ask the questions, Marson.
Now, just a minute.
Look, mister, you may as well know it. I'm an insurance investigator.
So Harrison said, but I don't believe it.
Right here, my credentials.
Uh-huh. Oh, I see, but I thought...
You thought I was just a boyfriend that Vonnie Lamarr met in La Jolla and who just came back here with her to comfort her over the loss of her father.
Yes, that's right.
Well, you were wrong, mister, or partly so. The main reason I'm here is to find out who murdered Thomas Lamarr and why. And I think I found out.
You have? Well, who, Mr. Dollar?
Interesting book you've been reading here.
Oh.
Flora Exotica Mediterranea. Stolen from the Central Library over in Chicago, wasn't it?
Well, yes. Yes, it was.
Found a poison in it, didn't you, Marson? Pyrodameron. Deadly, quick, and hard to trace. So rare that the chances were pretty good it wouldn't even be recognized. But it was. Where'd you get it, Walter?
As you said, at the library.
I'm talking about the poison, the pyrodameron that killed Thomas Lamarr.
Oh, no. You're all wrong.
Am I? Who besides Vonnie would benefit from the million and a half insurance on Lamar's life?
Well, what makes you think that...
I know
that
you
I'd
would,
be the...
because I know you're married to Vonnie.
Oh, no.
You tried to inveigle your way into Lamar's business, but he wouldn't have it. All your chiseling and conniving and phony stock transactions got you nowhere. So you did the next thing you could think of. You got something on Vonnie and forced her to marry you. So you thought you'd at least be sure of a big hunk of the insurance money over my dead
oh,
body.
Oh, no, look, Dollar, maybe I was married to Bonnie, but...
I found out about her big gambling debts, got her off the hook by some fancy manipulation of her foster father's investments. No doubt threatened to tell him all about it unless she did marry you, and thereby guaranteed yourself a prosperous future. Oh, and you timed the whole thing beautifully when she was emotionally upset over the death of Mrs. Lamarr.
No, Dollar, you don't know
but
what you're talking about.
Couldn't wait for him to die a natural death.
Dollar. Mr. Dollar.
Sure, go ahead, speak up and make it good.
Well, I was married to Vonnie. But I'm not now.
Sure.
That's right. I did want a place in Lamarr Metal Products, and I thought I could get it by showing Mr. Lamarr how clever I was. Well, instead of throwing me out, he gave me another chance. I'll be forever grateful to him. It was a turning point in my life. I give you my word, Mr. Dollar, I've done nothing since that time that's been anything but completely honest and above board.
Pretty speech.
No, it's true. It's true, I swear it.
Nevertheless, you married Vonnie in the hope
We're divorced.
You're what?
Well, it was the only honorable thing I could do. Would you like to see the final papers? Vonnie mailed them to me from Reno before she went to La Jolla.
You mean she... Yeah, let me see them.
Here. My... Yes.
Don't try to pull a gun out of there, Marson.
You still don't believe me, do you? Here they are.
Then would you like to tell me who did murder Thomas Lamarr?
I wish to heaven I knew. That's why I got this book, hoping to find some clue as to where the pirate Dameron might have come from.
But you sneaked this book out of the
library. Because I was afraid of the very kind of suspicion that you've shown.
Want to know something? I'm still showing.
And I tell you you're wrong. Ask Vonnie. She'll tell you.
Well, where is she? Harrison said you two had gone out together to make arrangements for the funeral.
Yes, we did, and we came back together. But when Harrison told her that you were here to see her, she said she'd be back in a few minutes.
Where did she go?
Oh, she's still in the house somewhere, I think.
Marson, just what is your relationship with Vonnie now?
Well, there never was any love between us. Our marriage was only on paper.
Yeah?
As the foster daughter of the man to whom I owe so much, it's my duty to do what I can for her. In spite of her.
Whatever what?
Oh, even to the end, we kept from him any knowledge of her dissipations, her drinking and gambling.
I thought that was all over.
Oh, she's more deeply in debt now than she's ever been. I'm thankful Mr. Lamarr died without knowing.
Well, I'll be.
But with the insurance, of course, she'll be able to pay off.
Marson, you're a dirty rat, and your accusation isn't very well veiled.
Are you trying to say that I'm accusing Vonnie of the... murder? Oh. Mr. Dollar.
Yeah, go on.
This book. According to this, the plant from which Pirate Dameron is derived is now extinct.
Unless somebody, somewhere, managed to salvage some seeds that were then planted.
Yes, exactly. Lepra purpurus calendus, found only on a small Grecian island. I wonder if Dimitri would know.
Dimitri? What's this sudden switch? Who's Dimitri?
He's the old gardener. He's here on the estate.
Come on, Marson, and bring that book. Before going out to the gardener's cottage, I asked Harrison where Vonnie had gone, and he told us he only knew that she was somewhere in the grounds, that a car was still in the driveway. I phoned Larry Comstock again, but he'd left his office, presumably to come out here. And I called the man I'd talked to earlier at the library.
Of course I can. As I told you before, I keep a very close check on the books in that section. Let me see now.
Yeah?
Yes, Flora Exotica Mediterranea has only been out 4 or 5 times in the past several years. Once to a Mr. Thomas...
Yeah?
Thomas Hanley.
Oh.
To a Mr. Ralph Cummings, Miss Lavon Lamarr, and...
That's enough. Thanks. I tried not to show Marson how I felt as we walked out to the cottage of Dimitri, the old gardener.
Could be nothing too nice for Mr. Lamarr. So I always try keep things nice.
Yeah, I can see.
Dimitri, Mr. Dollar's here to investigate the circumstances of Mr. Lamarr's death.
Investigate? Oh, yes. I hope you find who do this terrible thing to such a fine...
Well, I want you to look at this book. Here. Did you ever see a flower like that?
Oh, yes.
Yes, where?
In old country. In Greece it used to be, but no more.
You never saw it in this country?
No, yes.
Well, which is it?
I should not say, because in all countries, against the law. I don't know why.
Well, I do. Go on, Dimitri.
But I keep many of my nice seeds anyway.
And some of them were for this flower?
Yes. You don't mind? It is very pretty flower.
Did you ever plant any of them?
Oh, no, not I.
Somebody else?
She was always so nice to me.
Funny, Miss Lamarr.
Look, sir. She even sent me a gift on her trip last week.
Dimitri.
Look. You call it toilet case. See? It have soap and toothbrush and comb.
Dollar, look. That toothbrush.
I am looking. The yellow stain on the bristles, the same color as the flower on this deadly plant.
So pretty.
She sent her father one of these to her. Oh, Dollar, I'm sick.
You sick, poor man?
So crude, so corny, and so obvious it would never be noticed. And she was safely a couple of thousand miles away beyond any possible suspicion when the... Dimitri,
yes.
Did she plant any of these seeds you gave her?
She often plant many kinds.
Where? Show us.
In the morning, maybe. It's getting pretty dark now.
Now. Come on. Come on, Marson.
Yeah. You must not tell her I show you. She always keep her little garden secret. She not even think I know. She very sweet girl.
Yeah, very. But now...
Wait. She there now. Cultivating.
Cultivating? With a shovel? Dimitri, go back to your cottage and stay there.
Oh, you want...
Come on, Marson.
She's digging. Digging.
I think I know why.
She sees us.
Go back. Go away, both of you.
Stay here. I want to talk to you, Vonnie. What are you doing?
What I'm doing is... I'm burying the little garden that was mine for Daddy. Little personal things, Johnny, that I grew with my own hands for him alone. Now that he's gone, this would be only one more bit of memory. Please, leave me, Johnny, to finish.
Wait, Bonnie.
What?
Before you turn under that little yellow flower. Here, I'll show you.
No, Johnny, don't touch it.
Here. Source of a poison called pyrodameron.
How did you know?
Here, look.
Oh, no, you don't. I'll kill you, too. I'll kill you.
Oh, nobody, no.
Oh, Walter. Walter, help me.
Help you, help you.
Johnny was in love with me, but I turned him down, and he came out here.
No good, Bonnie.
I hate you. I hate you both. Everything would have been all right if you hadn't come along. I hate you. Listen, Johnny. $1 million. $1.5 million. You and I could...
Oh, you dirty...
No, Johnny, please don't. Please.
Believe me, this is one case I wish I'd never seen. Oh, sure, you, the company, are all right. You won't have to pay off $1.5 million in insurance. Your gain. But me, I've lost something. Faith. Faith in... I'm sick over the whole thing. Expense account, I'll add it up later. Right now, I'm going out and get roaring... Get some flowers. Some clean flowers. And just sit and look at them. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Now here's our star to tell you about next week's exciting story.
Next week, tell me... Did you ever wake up from a pleasant dream to find a smoking gun in your hand and two bodies at your feet? Well, I have. Join us next week, and I'll tell you about it. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Yours truly, Johnny Dollar, starring Bob Bailey, is transcribed in Hollywood. It is produced and directed by Jack Johnstone, who also wrote this week's story. Heard in the cast were Virginia Gregg, Lawrence Dobkin, Harry Bartell, Eric Snowden, Howard McNair, John Daner, Gene Tatum, Joseph Kearns, Paul Richards, and Jack Moyles. Musical supervision by Amerigo Marino. Be sure to join us on Monday night, same time and station, for another exciting story of yours truly, Johnny Dollar. Roy Rowan speaking.
Oh, that was a tough one. March 30th, 1956, yours truly, Johnny Dollar on Classic Radio Theater. And please visit us at our webpage, classicradio.stream, or you can find our podcasts anywhere fine podcasts are served. Just search for USA Classic Radio Theater. I'm Wyatt Cox. Thank this station. Support the advertisers. Tell a friend. The great radio shows are back. Classic Radio Theater here on your favorite station and the USA Radio Network.